Hey, everybody. Hi. Welcome to the program. I'm Jeff Gerstmann, your host for this week's installment of the Jeff Gerstmann Show. I'm happy to be here. And that must mean it's Tuesday. It can only mean one thing. We've made it to another Tuesday somehow. Here we are. It is April 11th. If you are in the United States of America, I hope you have finished your taxes. Mine are not quite done. I have some forms to fill out after the podcast that I just remembered I meant to fill out before the podcast. But here we are. Doing this program. It has been an interesting... Well, I was going to say an interesting week, but really it all kind of got packed into the last 24 or 48 hours, and we'll see how it goes from here. But my daughter got sick yesterday, and she woke up feeling sick, and we got her off to the doctor to take a look at her, and it was a stomach, some kind of stomach bug, and she was she vomited a couple of times. And she's gotten she's pretty good at making her way to the bathroom and taking, you know, like she did not make as much of a mess with that as I thought that she would, which is cool. But yeah, so we were like, oh man, okay, this is gonna rip through all of us, and that's no good for a variety of reasons. But yeah, I don't know. We got her some anti-nausea stuff, and she took that. She had a rough day yesterday. She had a real rough day. She was looking just like super glassy-eyed out of it. Like, she laid down in here for a while, and she sat out on the couch and just like was so, you know, like that thing of like you when you get so sick that you can't focus on more than one thing at once. And so she's just like staring at the TV, just kind of like all in on Peppa Pig. And I'm like, how are you feeling? And she's like, nothing. It's just like, okay, I'm going to get a little closer to you. How are you doing? She's like, okay. All right. And she's fine today, which is awesome, which is amazing. Hopefully the rest of us don't like get it, I guess. And, you know. But I don't know, you know, because you're thinking like, oh, is this norovirus? Is this something, you know, is this something bad? Is this going to be something that's going to really, you know, because my son's, what, 19 months old? And, you know, yeah, just like, it was like, okay, are we all getting this? You know, because I posted something on Instagram. I posted a picture like while she's like out of it on the couch. My son is having like the greatest day of his life. He's like, you know, he's running around. He's just like in the best mood possible. He opened up the back door, which has a glass thing on it. He's got his face pressed up against it. He's just like, ah, ha, ha. And I posted that and said like, oh, he's unconcerned. And you know, like half the comments on that are people going like, I had to go to the hospital for that. Hopefully you don't get it. I'm like, oh boy. But yeah, I don't know. Like that's kids, right? Is, you know, especially as she gets out more, and she's out every day in a different, you know, doing different stuff. But as she, you know, gets ready to go to school here before too long, and well, not like it's not kindergarten, it's some kind of, you know, pre thing. You know, she's gonna be around kids more, she's gonna be sick more, we're gonna be in that loop of everyone is sick all the time, you know. And you know, that just kind of comes with the territory or whatever. But I don't know. It feels like we've been like, we got this weird 3-year reprieve on that by everyone not leaving the house, you know? And it's like, that's awesome. I, you know, I, other than the part where we got COVID, haven't really gotten sick much over these last 3 years, which has been pretty great. But I assume that means that, you know, because we've been delaying her getting around other kids, and well, not delaying, I mean, she's around other kids now, but you know, when she'll really be packed into tighter spaces with kids inside and stuff like that, if that's when it's finally going to start and we're going to get all the colds and all the little, you know, sinus things and all this different stuff. We'll see how it goes, I guess. Cause that's always, you know, like when everyone was working in offices and everything, it was like, oh, my kid just went to school for the first time and now we're sick forever. And it's like, okay, well, don't come to work then. don't get everybody else sick. But, you know, hey. Yeah, so that was yesterday, but I also, like, with she was sitting on my lap most of the time. I got the latest episode of Game Boys to Men all edited and posted. If you are up on the Patreon at the appropriate tier, you can go listen to or watch that episode. That's an interesting one. It's we've kind of been putting it off. I don't know what, you know, like, I think it came out fine, but I think we put it off because I think we were both worried that it was going to be too angry or too just. We're talking about our time working at a magazine that we worked for. I worked there for a little under a year before they laid everybody off. Glenn was there a little while longer before me, but not there as long as I was, which is how Glenn likes to do it. Yeah, we went through the first issue. I took some pictures and of that first issue and posted them in the video. I'll post those on Patreon. I threw some of them on the Discord also. It's like the first column I ever wrote back in, you know, mid to late 1994 about how coffee houses are fucking terrible. I stand by that. Coffee house culture, let's just hang out. And it's gotten worse in a lot of ways. Actually, if we really want to revisit this topic, yeah, I mean, if you want to see it, you go to patreon.com/Jeff Gerstmann and you can read what I had to say about coffee houses in 1994. But now that you got these assholes that just like park there all day long with their laptop, treating it like it's an office, it's like, oh, that's like three times as shitty as like the shitty, you know, vaguely goth suburban kids smoking cloves out front and just sucking, which is pretty much what it was then. Anyway, yeah, you can go check that out. Of course, you get access to the Discord, you get early access to the Jeff Gerstmann Hall of Fame, and you also can get ad-free versions of this very podcast. With that in mind, or why don't we take a quick break? We'll come back. We'll talk about Terra Nil, Crab Champions, I don't know, Gunsuit Guardians. We'll talk about some video games. We'll do some stuff. We'll be back in a moment. You know, when it comes to just about anything you're trying to achieve in life, you know, trying to get more fit or just to be a more patient parent, get more done at work, just feel better during the day. One thing that can contribute to that is better sleep. And with Miracle Made Sheets, you can tap into the power of self-cooling temperature regulation, which has been shown to improve deep sleep quality by over 20%. Now, what are these Miracle Made Sheets all about? Self-cooling properties. That's right. They keep you cool at night for better quality sleep. They use silver-infused fabrics, originally inspired by NASA. That's right. They looked at what NASA was doing, and they said, we can bring this back down to Earth, and all Earth people can achieve a better night of sleep. Miracle-Made sheets are thermoregulating and designed to keep you at the perfect temperature all night long, so you get better sleep every night. And they're self-cleaning. That silver infusion can prevent up to 99.7% of bacterial growth, leaving them to stay cleaner and fresher three times longer than other sheets. That keeps them, you know, it keeps them from getting that stank on them. You know, that sheet stank, especially in the hotter time of year. I don't know if you're a sweaty sleeper. I'm not an especially sweaty sleeper, but there's a certain threshold. When we cross that threshold and things get a certain degree of warmth, I'll get a little moist at night, if you know what I'm saying. And hey, none of this would matter if these sheets didn't also deliver luxurious comfort and quality. Miracle sheets are luxuriously comfortable without the high price tag of some other luxury brands and feel as nice, if not nicer, than bed sheets used by some 5-star hotels. All this adds up to sheets that help you get better quality sleep and also better for your skin. Stop sleeping on bacteria. Clean sheets means less bacteria to clog your pores, and that leads to fewer breakouts and other skin problems. Go to trymiracle.com/Jeff to try Miracle-made sheets today. And with Mother's and Father's Day right around the corner, this is the perfect way to give someone you love the gift of better and more luxurious sleep. Save over 40% off, and be sure to use the promo code Jeff at checkout to save even more and get 3 free towels. Yeah, I know. Miracle is so confident in their product, it's backed with a 30-day money-back guarantee. So if you aren't 100% satisfied, you will get a full refund. Upgrade your sleep with Miracle Made. Go to trymiracle.com/Jeff and use the code Jeff to claim your free 3-piece towel set and save over 40% off. Again, that's trymiracle.com/Jeff to treat yourself. Thanks to Miracle Made for sponsoring this episode. All right, everybody, welcome back to the program. Let's talk about some. Well, I don't, you know, I want to crack into this before it gets too warm. I've got high hopes for this drink here. I've got a, what is this? This is a C4
Performance
Orange Cream. The orange cream has in flavors have in general been pretty decent lately. And also the fruit punch variant of this black can C4 has been very good. I bought another one of those. I got that in the fridge. That's my special treat. A drink I already drank before and like. But I don't know. I hopefully this is good. I don't know. It's what do we got here? Super Brain Performance. I love that. My super brain needs performance. Formulated with brain berry. What? That's not a thing. And clinically studied cognitive support ingredient, cognizine. Cognizine. Oh, what's this cognition thing you got? Oh, you mean cognizine? Always a good way to make it seem like it's a legit compound and definitely a real thing is when you name it like that. That's like, hey, check out our new laxative. It's take a shitazine. Shit your pants is all. Yeah, it's the newest compound. It's pretty great. You should check it out. This is 300 milligrams of caffeine. No sugar. No artificial dyes. Okay. And it's orange cream. So that's, again, orange cream. If you're not familiar, that's like a vanilla-y kind of creamy orange flavor. Like children's aspirin. Like children's chewable aspirin is the ideal. That's the ideal orange cream. Okay. This smells like orange cream. Okay. All right. We've got high hopes. Yeah, this is good. There's a little something on the end there that some of the other orange creams don't quite have because they're a little more, they don't have 300 milligrams of action in them. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is nice. I could drink 10 of these. Not back to back. That'd be a bad idea for a lot of reasons. But I could drink a case of these. Let's take a look at the list and get it on here. It's nice to have an energy drink that doesn't taste like it is killing me. Unlike a lot of the stuff we've been drinking lately, like this, I think that was the last one that made the list was this Faxacondi Booster Twisted Lemon. Oh, that is that not showing? Why is that not showing? There we go. A truly cursed beverage. A really nasty experience all the way around. This is very pleasant. I like this a lot. I don't think it's quite as good as Ghost Orange Cream. Or Rain Orange Dreamsicle. And I do love this Beaver Buzz, but this is probably a top 10 drink. Is it better or worse than Sour Patch Kids Red Berry? That's the question. Red Berry is very good. Tropical Storm is very good. You know, I think I know exactly where this is going to go. We're going to drop it right there. This is C4 Orange Cream. C-R-E-A-M or C-R-E-M-E? Are they fancy with it or what? And I don't know if is there a sub thing? Is this performance? Is this a sub? Because it's a different... I don't know if they just redesigned the cans or if the black can is something different. But we'll write C4 Performance Orange Cream just in case. And that is going to be our new... Number 7. A top 10 drink experience. I got to drink it the right way, though. I'm having a great time with this drink right now. Man, you could practically chug this. Oh, all right. Congratulations to C4 for a top 10 beverage. They got 1, 2, they got 3 in the top 10. Man. Who would have known? Until we started doing the science, until we started doing the research. To find out who would have known that this was a top 10 drink, right? In the world of video games, kind of a lot of smaller stuff has been on my radar lately. You know, we're kind of in a bit of a lull here. Let's see, Star Wars Jedi Survivor is out, what, like next week? And then the Horizon DLC is coming out pretty soon, too. I think that's around the same, you know, or yeah, okay. So it's 2 weeks out for Star Wars, and then is it maybe like one week later for, or 1 week earlier for the Horizon DLC? So, yeah, kind of a bit of a lull right now where, you know, I haven't, the Cyberpunk extreme crazy ray tracing mod just came out this morning. That was like a 3 gig download or something. No, it was bigger than that. I'll say it was like 20. Anyway, it was a download. I did not have time to fire that up before the show, but I will probably take a look at that. And so yeah, anyway, that has led to me playing some smaller stuff like Crab Champions, which streams some of that on Friday. I'm going to fire up Steam real quick just to get a look at how much some of this stuff costs so we can kind of be, you know, talking about it. Crab Champions is a horde mode game. And it is, so it's a wave-based survival game. You are going wave to wave. It is run-based, so you are kind of accruing different upgrades and stuff across the course of your run. It's yeah, okay. Yeah, people keep bringing up Risk of Rain 2, and it's much smaller in scope, I think, than Risk of Rain 2. It's an unfair comparison in both directions there, because Risk of Rain 2, I think, is a bigger game than this. And also, you know, in terms of levels and whatever else is going on. But Crab Champions is just way more action focused. Just get in there. It's a third person behind the back shooter. Also, you are a crab with a gun. And that's the hook. So you are gonna, and you are fighting crabs and giant ants, and well, I guess they're not giant ants. Maybe everyone's just tiny. I don't know. Maybe everything's the normal. So what's the ants are bigger than the crabs, so that would still be a pretty giant fucking ant. If you saw an ant that was bigger than a crab, you would be fucking scared. I don't like seeing regular ants. So the idea of an ant that was as big as, say, like a small to medium sized rat. If I saw an ant that was that big anywhere, behind bars, in a lab, you know, like out on the street, anything. I would pack it up. That's some Australia type shit. They're like, oi, we got ants the size of wallabies, you know, whatever. That's, yeah, I don't know. That's my hyper accurate. Arnar! That's my hyper accurate Australian impression. Weirdly enough, if I saw ants that were like EDF sized giant ants, that would be a little less terrifying than the ant that was the size of a small dog. That would be fucked up. Because it's a lot easier to envision, what if there were thousands of these? That'd be bad. Whereas if there were thousands of giant ants, society would be over, and you'd be like, well, it's been a fun ride, I guess. It's been a weird one. I can't say it's been all great, but boy, here we are, dying at the... you know, giant ants or whatever. Or yes, maybe I would go join the EDF and go get, I would be the flying one. No, I'd be the one that flies, the EDF guy that flies, the flying lady. Is that, it's been a long time since I've looked at an EDF game. That's the other problem. You know, I don't feel like the EDF games are properly training us for what it will be like when the insects truly do invade, and they are giants, because that game is so bad. Well, maybe it's accurate and it really will be that bad. We just be like, well, I don't know. These ants just fall through the terrain. When you kill them, they just stop animating and vanish. Just, I understand that there's a camp aspect to EDF, but I just don't like the way they play. If it was campy and silly and some of the animations were bad and all of that, but like the shooting felt good and the movement felt great. And, you know, if it had all that stuff down, you'd be like, yeah, cool. This is like, I don't know, it's Dynasty Warriors, but fun, or something like that. But instead, all of that stuff is rotten too. Anyway, I don't know. This, maybe someday it would be pointless. I was about to say maybe someday we'll get a good EDF game, but that would be dumb. It'd be dumb to start making them better now. Yeah, so gosh, Crab Champions is pretty good. It's pretty early accessy. You know, it looks like it's going to have unlockable skins and, you know, a variety of weapons. You do have a melee attack, and, you know, there's multiple biomes and boss fights, and there is online. I've only played it offline, but, you know, it's a very straightforward you know, kind of horde mode. Again, wave-based survival, as we say, around these parts. And it's $10. It's $10, but, and I guess the thing I'll say about it is that the movement is really good in it. Like, the mobility of this crab is silly. You can double jump. If you hit the left bumper while moving forward or backwards, you will slide. And so it's kind of a high-speed slide. And if you jump out of the slide, you get more distance. And that, all that mobility kind of adds up to, like, this is actually really fun. You know, you're kind of like double jumping sideways and strafing. And it's surprisingly good for the $10 crab game that you get the impression is just like, yeah, it's kind of a weird joke. Yes, right. Yes, Fat Scout says, seems like Crab Champions exists because the guy who made the Crab Rave song and video got that grant from Epic and then decided, I'm going to make a crab shooter now. So yeah, kind of a weird extra little wrinkle to all of that, I guess. But it's fun. It is a fun little shooter. I don't know if I'll play it a thousand times, you know, or anything like that. I'm not like, I don't know that I'm like super hooked on it in that sort of way. But like the structure of it seems sound. The movement and shooting feels pretty good. And so if it keeps getting good updates over the course of early access, then it'll be a cool little thing. I don't know. $10, you know, I don't know. Like, the value of games is so weird. Like, it's really hard to go like, well, it's great. It's a 10. I mean, it's only $10, but, like, you know, then you look at like Vampire Survivors for, you know, $3, $4, whatever it was. And it's hard. The comparisons start getting weirder and weirder. But yeah, you know, it does have online multiplayer. It doesn't have any matchmaking, so it looks like you gotta kind of look at your Steam friends list and pull some people together that way to do co-op runs. And yeah, it's pretty neat. It's you would look at it and go, what is this weird joke? But it seems like a weird joke where they kind of nailed aspects of the feel in a way that you go like, this is actually fucking crazy fun, like sliding around doing these double jumps, like all this, just the movement stuff and some of the silly weapons and silly perks kind of make it a pretty engaging little thing. So I would say at least look at it. I streamed it on Friday. There's a video up on YouTube if you want to get a look at it in action, which I would probably recommend before you just shell out for it. But played some of that. I went back and I started a new game of Jedi Fallen Order, which is the previous Star Wars Jedi game. I'll never get, it's dumb that I'm even pointing it out, but I will never get used to the very idea of the, oh yes, the Star Wars Jedi franchise. Like the Star Wars Jedi : Fallen Order. Like this, I still feel like the names of these games are bad. I don't. If they just called it, I mean, Jedi: Fallen Order works. Jedi: Survivor works. It's just when you throw Star Wars on the front of it that the whole thing goes like, gets a little weird. Maybe if it was like EA Sports Jedi Fallen Order, maybe that would make a little more sense. I don't know. So Fallen Order is the, you know, obviously Survivor is out really soon. I had just gone and played some Survivor, which we talked about last week. And so I was like, you know, I never did finish Fallen Order. Maybe I'll give that another look and see if it grabs me in a way that makes me want to play through the whole thing. And so I started over on PC. It's a gorgeous video game. You know, it's a few years old now, obviously, but just still a really awesome looking game. Just great lighting and just good. And I guess I'll say, like, you know, the comparisons to Survivor start to stand out a little more. Where you go like, oh, it seems like the lighting in Survivor, the lighting off your lightsaber feels a little bit better and more realistic than it does in Fallen Order. Like in dark places, you can just hold down block and he'll pull out his lightsaber and that'll light up the area. That feels like a little cooler and more natural looking in the new one than it does in this one. Also, it's very hard to start a game and not have most of the abilities like wall running and double jumping and force push and force pull and everything, like the demo where they set us up, you already had all the basic tools and you were like an hour in the game. And so yeah, you know, going back and after, like, you know, they have a line and they were like, my connection to the force is messed up, and the lady was like, it'll come back. And then like 10 minutes later you're like meditating and going, oh, wall running, right, wall running. And then you can wall run. You're like, okay, right. Your connection to the force is, of course, totally screwed up. I had also forgotten, you know, playing the new one and then playing this one again, that there's like aspects of this, especially in the map, where like they looked at Metroid Prime and said, let's have that map, which I don't think that's the best choice. I think the map in Survivor is a little more effective and a little more readable than maybe this one is. Random dude in the Twitch chat is asking, does the sequel have the same protagonist? If so, I hope they found a way to make it more likable. It does. The new one is set 5 years after the events of the first game, and so he's a little more out, I guess I would say. He is not living in a Jedi closet, which I guess, you know, is really only in the first 20 minutes of that first game. But yeah, he's got a shitty beard now, and you can customize the beard if you want him to have a sick mustache instead. You can do that. And yeah, so going back to that first game, you're like, yeah, this game is really cool too. But then there's quality of life stuff like fast travel, you know, and some of the other stuff in the new game. You're like, yeah, okay, all right. There's definitely they have definitely expanded on a lot of things from that first game. You kind of see that a little more readily now that I'm kind of like a little more current with that previous game. So it was, I don't know, it's been interesting to go back to that. I think it's that game is still pretty cool. It's available. That thing is constantly on sale too. I don't know how much they're charging for it these days. I know at one point they were like, hey man, you want Jedi Fallen Order on Steam? It's $4. And you're like, okay. So play that if you haven't, I guess. Also played some Terra Nil, which I had been looking forward to for a while. This is the, I guess I'd say it's the opposite of a city builder, right? You are getting into an environment. The idea is that you want to remove the human presence, the poison, the wasteland presence from an environment and restore it back to nature, where places where animals can live, and then totally pull yourself out of the equation. And leave only footprints. And so this is, you know, an isometric tile-based city builder kind of interface. But your goals are to, okay, you're going to put down a wind turbine, and that provides power that you can use to power a thing that removes toxins from the environment so that the water is clean and so that the grass can grow again. And then once that's done, you can turn areas into forests and kind of create a little ecosystem and, you know, modify the humidity by how you kind of, it becomes a puzzle game. It's really more of a puzzle game because you're doing this to an environment and then it's like, okay, you're done. Move on to the next one and do it here. It's not like a city builder where you're like, okay, I'm going to spend 100 hours on this city. It's more like, okay, we're here. It's fucked up. We're going to put in some stuff to unfuck it. And then we're going to leave. And then we're going to go to the next one and unfuck that place too. And it's really neat. You know, you start to adjust the humidity and you know, put down wetlands and kind of modify the different areas, you are, then it's like, oh, it's raining now because the humidity is such that this is a rainy place now, or this is a rainforest now. And, you know, you eventually might want to start a fire to burn down a forest because it's fun. Because you are then using the ash to, you know, kind of change the environment in a different way. And eventually you're at a point where it's like, okay, now we, you know, in order to get animals here, it's almost like a sort of, it becomes a little Viva Pinata-esque, you know, how you have like, well, we need to have this many flowers and this much of this before this pinata will come to our place. It's sort of like that, where it's like, okay, this area needs to have this amount of flat lands, but it needs to be close to a forest, and then we can have deer be here. And, you know, so you're kind of bringing animals to the environment. And then at the end, you create a little airship and a little recycle skiff, and it goes around on the water, and you have to then pull your wind turbines and all the other stuff that you built out of the environment. And once you've cleaned it all up and got the animals back in it, you're like, okay, cool. Now we're going to fly away. It's a neat little cycle that you go through. And obviously it gets more complicated over time. You know, the second area is a more tropical island kind of thing. And so there's water surrounding it, and that water is filthy. And so you've got to clean that water out. You've got to use the salt water to turn into rocks and so that you can, because you can build wind turbine on top of rocks. And so you need that kind of platform to build. And, but yeah, it is much more of a puzzle game than kind of a traditional kind of city building thing, because you are moving from place to place to place. And so Terra Nil is, it's perhaps best described as a puzzle game. And that's cool. There's a part of me that I am in the mood for a city builder, and I don't know. I keep talking about SimCity 2000, and I'm a little scared to go back to SimCity 2000 because I loved that game so much. But I wonder if I went back to it now, would I just go like, oh, this interface is blah, this is bad. This, you know, like this stuff's so dated or whatever. But, yeah, I don't know. I am in the mood for some long-term kind of build a big city for 100 hours kind of game, and maybe I should just reinstall City Skylines or really just wait for the sequel. And play that when finally comes. That's like end of this year or something, right? But I don't know. I'll have to take a look and see what the what are the other options in that space? Because Terra Nil is cool, and I came away from it going like, this is a really awesome idea, but also, you know, the way you kind of like finish an environment and move on to the next one kind of doesn't scratch that itch that I'm looking for right now. I think if this was this game, but it was like, oh, there's kind of constantly new poisons coming in, and you kind of have to maintain that balance over a long period of time or whatever, and it was more of a, you know, you, this is your environment, which again, I guess the whole point of Terra Nil is that you are not part of the environment, you are fucking fixing it and leaving. So the very idea that I'm like, no, I want to stay here and fuck with it some more, like, no, that's the missing the entire point of the goddamn game. But yeah, I don't know. Terra Nil is really cool. They have said that they're going to work on it more. That was one of the discussion points. I think, you know, the game kind of captured the imaginations of folks when that trailer first hit and when the game first got announced. And I think their vision for it at the time was something quite small. And as that interest has grown, I think they have probably found themselves in a spot where they can afford to put more into the game. So the game is out now, and they have a post on their Steam page saying like, hey, we're taking a break because Jesus, we shipped a game. But we will be back to continue to work on it. We've got more ideas in mind and all of that. So I think they are intending to add more to it over time, which is cool to see. It's cool to see like, hey, this game attracted an audience and now we're going to do more with it. I think that's neat. It's neat when things work out that way, I guess. Other couple little games I've been playing. I checked out Wall World. Wall World is a vertical mining game. You mine stuff in Wall World. The world of Wall World is a world where everyone lives on a wall, and no one knows where the top or the bottom of the wall is. Yeah, it is similar to Dome Keeper. That was how it was originally pitched to me. Someone on the Discord said, I should probably write that down. Someone on the Discord suggested it, and someone was part of the Gerstmann advisory panel. So sort of like Dome Keeper, it's a game where you were in a mine doing mining to get resources, and then occasionally your base is being attacked, and so you need to go back to the base to man a turret so that you can fend off the attacks, and then between waves you get to go into mines and mine. And so in this case, your base is a big walking spider tank, and you pick it up and walk it up and down the wall. So the whole right side of your screen is the spider tank and the wall. And then the whole left side of the screen is where enemies come in and attack you. So it's a weird perspective on things because you're on a wall. And so you are creebling up and down this wall, and occasionally you'll find cracks in the wall. That's where you can stop, park your spider, and go in and do your mining. And you'll find like, oh, here's a dead body, but it's got a perk on it, and I can pick this up and, you know, bypass some of the upgrades. It has run-based upgrades as well as persistent upgrades. Stop me if you've heard this before. Like every other video game released in the last few years, it has a persistent upgrade system while also having in-game run-based upgrades. This is a mind-blowing combo, I know. But here we are yet again. And so some of those are things like, hey, the, you know, much like in Dome Keeper, the turn rate on the turret fucking sucks. And so you have to put points into upgrading that speed so that you can simply aim it more quickly to take on the targets. And then you can make it so it does more damage and has an increased fire rate. You can upgrade your miner so he can hold more things so that he can dig faster, and so on and so forth. The types of upgrades you may expect to find in a game such as this, many of them are present. That's not a bad thing. I don't know. It's you know. But the other thing I'll say is it's fucking weirdly brutal, or I'm playing it wrong or something. So, you know, you eventually, when you dig out a mine, and the individual areas are not often that big, And then you have to go back to your spider tank and then crawl up and down the wall until you find another crack in the wall and then go in, and that's a whole new mine. And so I am doing that 3 or 4 or 5 times, finding 5 different holes in the wall, and then I just keep crawling and crawling, and eventually you kind of find a different like area. It's like, oh, it's cloudy here. And then the next wave of enemies that attacks seems to just be overwhelming. It's like, okay, there was no way I could have afforded enough upgrades at this point to truly fend off these attacks. Both sides of my thing are getting hit. There are also enemies in the sky firing at my weird spider. And so I'm fucked. And so those persistent upgrades that will increase your damage, increase those sort of things, seem like the big thing that will help mitigate that. But also, I don't know, in wall world, do I need to stick in my home area longer and not walk into the cloud zone? Is that what's causing it? There's also a timer on screen, and I suspect when that timer expires, there's probably a boss or something you got to deal with. And so, yeah, I don't know. My time with wall world has been short and brutal, where my spider tank gets horrendously brutalized. And then you go, oh, geez, okay, I guess I got to start over. Maybe I'll get better perks this time. And yeah, so I played 3 or 4 or 5 runs of it, and I was like, this is a really neat idea. And hopefully kind of keep, I'm going to check and see if this is early access or if this is done insofar as games are ever done. It has an update queued. Made things less brutal. No. Fixed an issue with weapons jamming when changing weapons during a dash. You dash? Shit, man. All right. Maybe I probably have not unlocked that yet. All right. It is not listed as being in early access, but these updates in this patch that hit today seem at least somewhat substantial. Wall World is cool. Also, it's like $4. So, yeah, go look at the trailer for Wall World. I think if you liked Dome Keeper, or liked the idea of Dome Keeper, but maybe didn't love Dome Keeper, that's the bucket I found myself in, where it's like, I wish Dome Keeper had a little more depth or something going for it, because it's kind of, the options didn't seem fantastic. I would give Wall World a look. You might find that it's right up your alley. I also have, last night I fired up a game called Gunsuit Guardians. Someone on Twitter recommended this to me. It's an ass game. If you're all about that ass, Gunsuit Guardians, well, okay, it's ass optional, I guess. Much like Time Wasters, it is ass optional. It is an auto shooting survival game, but also you can use the right stick to manually aim. In fact, there's a toggle where you can turn off the auto aim and just make it a dual joystick shooter. So you can go either way. If you're all about that ass, you can get up in that ass and let it fire automatically. If you are like, ass, no, thank you, I do not want that ass, then you can turn it into a more traditional dual joystick shooter. And in this one, there's, I don't, you know, what does make this one different than the others? I don't know. It's got some run-based perks and then also a out-of-game progression system where you can buy more persistent upgrades. And anyway, I played like an hour and a half of this last night, and I'm like still struggling to fucking define it. You are floating around on in kind of a jetpack. You are a little dude in a gun suit, perhaps. And you are flying around in the skies, and there are a bunch of enemies, little alien goobers that are flying around you that you are shooting. Some of them shoot back. Sometimes there are bigger enemies. Sometimes there are big cubes that drop coins and health upgrades or whatever else. You'll find enemies that drop mystery perks that once you've picked them up once, they are no longer mysteries. And you go like, oh, this is This one adds 20% damage to ballistic weapons. This one adds 20% damage to fire weapons. This one, you know, different types of upgrades along those lines. It is wave based. So every 5 waves, you're fighting a boss. And this one is early access and it is $3. So if you're on the hunt for more ass games, Gunsuit Guardians is a, it's a pretty good feeling one. This one, I guess I would say you start out feeling particularly weak in that the first time I got to the level 5 boss, I felt completely ill-equipped to kill it because the amount of damage I was doing was so low. So like a lot of other games of this type, by completing achievements, you are unlocking additional weapons and additional perks and little things there that you can then purchase to make a part of your run in a more permanent fashion. And so after a few games of like, oh, I leveled the base weapon up to level 10. That means now a shotgun can roll when I level up and whatever else there's kind of that whole thing. I'm trying to like if I had to define this in a way that made it sound different from other games of its type, I just don't know that I have anything really to say on that front other than this one has a pretty good feel to it too. The shooting feels nice. Again, you can hit the right bumper at any time to turn off the auto targeting and turn it into a more generic kind of dual joystick shooter experience, which is handy for the boss, I found, actually. It's like, oh, okay. Like, if I spend less time shooting all the enemies around me and really focus on wearing down the boss, I can take him out. But that took a few runs of also, like, leveling up, because one of the persistent upgrades you can buy is the ability to hold more weapons at once, which is nice. So yeah, it's a good feeling ass game. There are so many of these now, and some of them feel pretty terrible. So I guess I would say this is in the camp of this one feels nice. So I think that alone is if you're still interested in this style of game. I mean, whatever. Vampire Survivors DLC is coming out real soon, right? They're dropping more updates there. So I don't know if that's going to suck up all the ass, the ass players, if they're just going to get back into Vampire Survivors once that DLC drops or what have you. But yeah, as far as an early access thing, I think, Gunsuit Guardians feels like it's got a good foundation. And as they add more to it, I think it will continue to, you know, grow into a better and better game. Initially, I was kind of put off by I like my ass to be pure. I like my auto shooting survival games to be absolutely pure and not offer the option of manual targeting. It feels like a cop out to me. It feels like you're not going all ass. That's what I want. I want 6 hours all ass, like the tapes at the gas station. And when you make it kind of a dual joystick shooter, it's like, I like those too, but I like those for different reasons, I guess. And so when you mix the two, when you mingle the two together, it's a little weird. I don't know. I think that's just my hang up on that stuff. There's another game. There's a demo of it. I'll see if the demo is still available. I had the demo installed. And then played 2 runs of it, and then, yeah, Rhythm Storm. The full game is not coming out until, I guess, Q4 of this year, but there is a demo available on Steam that you can get, and is from Radiant Games, who you may remember from such games as Devastator and Instruments of Destruction, which is interesting. But Rhythm Storm is kind of a vector graphics-styled ass game with rhythmic elements. The enemies kind of move and spawn in time to the music, and it's got a really great vibe to it. Rhythm Storm. There's a demo of that out. The full game, I guess, will not be out until closer to the end of the year. So Rhythm Storm seems really impressive. I really enjoyed my time with that, but it is a very brief demo. So, we'll have to kind of wait and see what the full game holds there. And what else? That's about it. Well, okay. I forgot to talk about it last week. I guess we should talk about Crime Boss Rockay City. What a piece of garbage. What a real, like, a just a really... So this is Crime Boss Rockay City was a game when they put out the trailers and they were like, look, we've got all these stars. It's got Michael Madsen. It's got Chuck Norris. It's got Kim Basinger. It's got Vanilla Ice. And you look at that and you go, oh boy, this doesn't seem... Like, I think from the get-go, there was a thing looking at it going like, this doesn't seem good. like, if because the entire focus was on the cast. And not on, like, check out this game we made. And so you look at it and you go like, okay, it's like it looks like a first-person shooter. It looks vaguely like you're doing bank heists. And so if the entirety of the game is this, then you look at it and go like, okay, if this is the entire game, then this is kind of like a Payday knockoff. But maybe this is just a, you know, maybe they're just showing this part of the game and it's a full story-based first-person shooter. Like, you know, because like they're kind of trading off of this Vice City-ish, GTA-ish kind of vibe in those trailers. And so, like, from the initial announce, or from the initial trailer, at least, you look at it and you go, I'm not 100% sure what this is. This could be a first-person GTA knockoff, or this could be a really fucking narrow kind of Payday clone. It is more of the kind of narrow Payday clone. And so I guess like, so I guess to be fair to Crime Boss Rockay City, I have not tried the co-op multiplayer, but it does have a single player mode that is like a weird run based thing where if Michael Madsen's character dies, you have to start over. And so you go on these heists. You do not have to take Michael Madsen with you in all of those cases. So you can hire additional people to be part of your crime, your crime syndicate or whatever. But the writing is so fucking miserable, where like Michael Madsen is, I guess, the Candyman. And so he's always talking about, we gotta go get my candy. It's like, you mean all these bags of drugs? Are you 12? What the fuck? And just the language, or the mismatch between, like, you know, the captions and the spoken dialogue is a problem. It's just, the writing is fucking abysmal. The way these people speak is dire. And it's a shitty Payday knockoff where you're like, okay, we're going to try to not set off alarms, and we're going to try to steal stuff. And oh, the alarm got set off, and oh, now the cops are coming. And oh, wait, there's a let up in the cop response. And now we have time to pick some more stuff up and try to get to the getaway vehicle. And oh, another wave of pressure from the cops. And oh, we got them. And oh, da, 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 da. Like that kind of back and forth. The shooting feels like absolute shit. I was in disbelief when I first, like, remember, these are characters that are supposed to be fucking like hardened criminals. They're like, I've been on the streets. I'm Michael Madsen. Listen to my voice. You know, I know how to shoot a gun. Apparently fucking not. Apparently he's fucking too shaky from too much candy. This is like, he's just all over the place. The recoil feels fucking totally random and fucked up. Like the shooting feels abysmal. You start to get upgrades pretty quickly that are like lower recoil. And you're like, okay. And that reins it into a point where you're like, okay, this is now like a somewhat acceptable feeling first-person shooter. But gosh, just an abysmal fucking video game. Just terrible. Just feels terrible top to bottom. And so between heists, you're kind of on a map screen and you're taking over territory and you're hiring more members for your crime army. And then you're deploying that army around the map to take the territory from the other gangs. And there's neutral territory that you don't even have to, like, go do a mission to take. You just devote 10 guys. And it's like, I guess that's my territory now. And so as over the course of your run, you're trying to take all that territory and I don't know, get your candy back or whatever. And so between missions, you're like, let's go talk to Michael Rooker about what we're going to do next. And then he says, we're going to go fuck these guys up. Sports. Because his name is Touchdown. I call the plays. It's shitty. It's a shitty game. And they must have been paying people, like release week or something, because I saw like two or three videos on TikTok, like 3 or 4 days after release, that were like clips of the game. You know, it was like stream archive footage or whatever it was. And it was people going like, look at this. I'm having an awesome time with crime boss Rockay City. What an awesome video. And I'm just like, what the fuck? Like, these people are clearly on the team. Like, this has to be a sponsored post. This has to be. No one is having a great time with crime boss Rockay City. It's impossible. So it's unfortunate. You know, you look at it and go like, oh, you know, there's probably some game in there where you're like, again, if this was the cast for a Grand Theft Auto style of game, you know, you could believe it. Go like, yeah, sure, man. I don't know. Vanilla Ice. He's a character in our shitty fake 80s, fake Miami crime game. You're like, yeah, sure. But the way all of those characters are implemented is embarrassing. And the line delivery, again, people hire voice actors for a reason, right? Because they know how to talk into a microphone effectively and believably. And, you know, Michael Madsen, Michael Madsen has had some amazing roles over his career. I love some of his work on the silver screen. But that doesn't immediately translate to voice acting, you know, like it's a different skill. This game proves more than most, I think, that acting versus voice acting are two very different things. And I'm not going to sit here and tell you that I think that Chuck Norris is an amazing actor. I thought he was really good in Return of the Dragon, the Bruce Lee film. He's fantastic. He's fantastic in that movie as Colt. You ever seen The Octagon? I've been meaning to watch The Octagon. It's a Chuck Norris movie. But then Chuck Norris plays Sheriff Norris in this game. And it is maybe the worst voice performance I have ever heard in a shipping video game. I guess, let me back that up. By someone who is meant to be a name. By someone who is meant to be like, we brought in a name voice. We brought in name actors for this. In terms of like how those performances. This is worse than Michael Madsen in Yakuza back on the PlayStation 2. The classic.
What fun.
You know, this is worse than he was there. It is beyond phoned in. It is the most like he is seeing these words for the first time and he is reading them and then they're going, let's move on. Yeah, then you nailed it. Like he's like, oh, I wasn't trying to do sure. All right. Yeah. Dark Allen asks, worse than Bruce Willis in that one PlayStation 1 game? Dramatically worse. Bruce Willis in that one PlayStation 1 game is acting. Is he doing it well? Hard to say. But he is like yelling and going, oh no, we're getting shot. You know, like whatever. He's like, there's something there. This is like, I'm going to get these guys. Like it is like mind-blowingly bad how the Chuck Norris performance in this game. I was shocked. It which makes it hilarious in its own sick way. But the rest of the yes, exactly. It sounds like a mic check. It sounds like they're like, oh, you know, okay, just read this a couple of times and see what you like. And then they ended up using those. Apocalypse on the PlayStation 1, the Bruce Willis game, is like part of the reason, and I don't know that this would have made it better, but part of the reason why the voice experience in that game is so bad, and it's not, well, whatever, but part of the reason why the voice experience in Apocalypse, why the Bruce Willis performance in Apocalypse on the PlayStation 1 feels weird, is because they originally recorded him as your sidekick. And the original pitch for that game is you're going to be some dude, and then Bruce Willis is the guy who runs with you, and then he yells shit. And then at some point in development, the story I always heard was like, they realized, oh, people don't want to be Bruce Willis's friend. They want to be Bruce Willis. So we changed it, so you're Bruce Willis. And I wonder if it was that, or if it was like a performance thing. Well, you can't have two guys running around on screen. The frame rate takes a hit. I'm sure that there's probably a variety of reasons why they made that change. But that didn't mean that they then magically got to have another session with Bruce Willis recording the voice lines. And so my understanding, and this is my understanding of how it went, is that they had to then look at everything they had recorded for the other version of the game and go, okay, what can we salvage here? What can we pull out from Bruce's performance and use in the game? What makes sense with you as Bruce, as opposed to you as Bruce's buddy? And so that's why Apocalypse on the PlayStation 1 is weird the way it is because they kind of had to go in and salvage a lot of that stuff. That was always my understanding of it. That's something like it'd be fun to talk to someone who worked on that game nowadays, actually, all these years later, and go, hey, what was that like? Like shifting that midstream. And how'd all that go? People in chat are like trying to compare it to like Peter Dinklage in Destiny, and like, no. Again, like, you might not like that performance, but he's fine in that game. He did a fine job. He did a totally appropriate job. Like, there were a couple of lines where you're like, that's a little weird. But, like, none of it was egregious. Like, again, this Chuck Norris performance is, like, mind-blowing from what I did hear of it. Like, people are like, there are people in chat that when we were streaming it, there were people who were like, oh, man, did they generate a Chuck Norris AI voice? Because it sounds that bad that you like can't believe that it's a human speaking into a microphone. You're like, oh, they must have made a Chuck Norris, voice AI thing, and then just typed in, we're going to get those bad guys, or, you know, whatever the fuck the line is. Crime Boss Rockay City is pretty awful. And again, I will point out again in fairness, I have not tried the multiplayer mode of that game, but just the way the shooting feels and all of that, like, you know, ordering the AI around to pick up bags during a heist and ordering them to escape and whatever else, like, that's clunky and shitty in ways that if you had humans with you would probably be a little bit smoother, but I have a hard time buying that, like, that's going to magically make the shooting feel fucking acceptable, or that the environments will be better. You know, like, there's just so many funky aspects to that game that experiencing it with friends doesn't seem like it would actually be a better experience. So yeah, I don't know. That's Crime Boss Rockay City. I'm glad we talked about it, because now we don't have to anymore. It would be fun to see a compilation of the Chuck Norris dialogue. Like, if anyone ever like went and compiled all the voice lines and stuff, that'd maybe be fun. I don't know. Listening to that once and going, whew, boy. Why don't we take another break? And we'll come back and we'll talk about the news. Nintendo is going to put on a show. It's crazy. We'll be right back after this. All right, it's time to take a pause for the cause. And what's that cause, you might ask? Well, that cause is rock hard, throbbing, veiny erections. That's right. This episode is brought to you in part by Blue Chew. Hey, is your penis not doing what it's supposed to do? Remember, it used to always be ready to get down. To get down? Is that word? Did I just say get? Is it ready to get down? Man, remember when always was ready for action? Is that better? Is it ready for action?
Ready to get down and get dirty.
It's not dirty. Hey, dirty. That's dirty is in the mind of the beholder. But hey, remember the days when your penis was always ready to get going. Now, if it's not doing that, you can increase your performance and get that extra confidence in bed with BlueChew.com. Now, what is Blue Chew? This is a fantastic question. Blue Chew is a unique online service that delivers the same active ingredients as Viagra, Cialis, and Levitra, but in chewable tablets and at a fraction of the cost. You can take them anytime, day or night, so you can plan ahead or be ready whenever an opportunity arises. The process is very simple. You sign up at BlueChew.com, consult with one of their licensed medical providers, and once you're approved, you'll receive your prescription within days. And hey, this is all done online. No visits to a doctor's office, no awkward conversations, no waiting in line at the pharmacy. They just discreetly mail you these tablets, and then you're good to go. And then you're ready for when the need arises. Should you need that extra confidence? Should you need a little something extra to get that rock solid slab ready for sexing? If you need a little something extra so you can give your partner a little something extra, then hey, investigate BlueChew.com. Blue Chew's tablets are made in the USA, and they're prepared and shipped direct to your door, again, in a discreet package. The whole world does not need to know. Though maybe you might want to let them know, hey, if you're looking to get broken off, hey, we're blowing out backs by the dozen over here. Now, I don't know, what do you, I don't know, hey, whatever you're into. Blue Chew wants to help you have better sex, regardless of what you're into. Blue Chew wants to help you have better sex. Discover your options at BlueChew.com. Chew it and do it. And we've got a special deal right here for you. Try Blue Chew for free when you use our promo code Jeff at checkout. Just pay $5 shipping. That's BlueChew.com, promo code Jeff, to receive your first month for free. Visit BlueChew.com for more details and important safety information. And thanks to Blue Chew for sponsoring the podcast. Okay, we're back. Let's talk about the news. I pushed to the news button, so you know it's real. Nintendo Live is returning, and it's returning to the United States. This is a live show that they did in Japan. I guess it was the last time they did it. It was like 2019, you know, back when you might have a live event. This morning, Nintendo announced plans to have a live event in September in Seattle. It is called Nintendo Live 2023. They are billing it as an all-ages celebration of Nintendo fun. Share the excitement of playing games together, enjoying live stage performances, and more across a large-scale themed area. Whether you and your family are new to the games, characters, and worlds of Nintendo, or are lifelong fans, everyone's welcome to have fun. This is a public event. This is a, hey, come, you know, bring your kids, bring your stuff, and we're putting on a show. The things they are billing as being there, their page is very light. The press release they put out is not extremely detailed either. But again, this is a public facing event. This is something that they are going to like probably sell tickets to. This is not an industry event. This is not something that will necessarily have a bunch of brand new announcements. They may do something like that there, but again, no immediate guarantee that this is going to be some big thing. They may have a handful. Anyway, games. This is the part that kind of makes me want to try to temper people's expectations about what this thing may actually be, especially when you go back and look at the event in Japan, what they did. Have a blast together with popular Nintendo Switch games. Play familiar favorites at your own pace. Jump into friendly competitions together or try something new to you. There's nothing in there about, you know, hey, check out the latest unreleased Nintendo Switch games. I would not be shocked if they did have one or two things there that maybe weren't quite out yet. But this to me sounds like a PAX level of event where Nintendo at PAX would have like, oh, we got one or two things here that are not quite out yet, but it's, you know, it's right around the corner. Pre-order now. You know, it's not like, hey, we just announced a thing and we've got a trailer and we've got this and, you know, it's perhaps not that type of show. And them saying September in Seattle makes me wonder, because PAX West is, that is technically, or PAX Prime, what do they even call it now? I guess they just call it PAX West. Okay, I guess they have not announced dates for it yet. Yeah, we don't know quite yet, but that's typically September, like Labor Day weekend is always kind of when PAX happens. And so I almost wonder if this is something that will happen in conjunction or piggybacked around PAX, because there will already be another event in town, or if they're going to have this as a totally separate thing. We'll kind of have to wait and see what they end up doing timing wise. But live stage, bring your energy and enjoy live stage performances, thrilling competitions, and more. Photo ops, meet and snap a share-worthy picture with some of your favorite Nintendo characters. Check out sculptures that faithfully bring in-game worlds to the real world, and other fun stuff. And tournaments, cheer on top competitors as they go for the gold in high-level play. More information coming soon. And they've got a picture of Yoshi, so you know they mean business. That's cool. I think that makes a ton of sense. I think like them having a more public event type things and running it themselves, I mean, they're freaking Nintendo, you know? Whether this happens in conjunction with an actual set of announcements, or there's like a Nintendo Direct attached to this, or a Nintendo Direct that happens 2 weeks before this and isn't directly attached to this, we'll kind of have to wait and see. It's, you know, this seems like something that, like, at the end of the show, they get up there and say, like, we're making a new Mario game. And then there's a picture of Mario jumping on the screen behind him. And then he says, Mushroom Kingdom, here we come. Or he says, I can't believe it. I am Mario. You know, it's the sort of stuff they've done in Japan before. And it's really a family-focused event. It's really, like, them trying to just put on a live public show. So I think, you know, seeing people run away from this and go like, oh, this is going to be their E3. Like, they may have some announcements here. They may have one or two things that they're ready to say here, but again, they may just as likely do a direct somewhere else around that. And then, you know, yeah, have concerts. Like, yeah, the Splatoon concert, whatever it is, have an orchestra show up and play some Zelda music for people. Totally. That seems like the type of show. And that all sounds cool. I don't know. Like that's, you know, it's my guess is that this is even more, because remember the PlayStation experience when PSX was a thing. A lot of that show was focused on unreleased games, and there were like reasons to go there if you were like press. So like that was the first time I played Rez. The more recent re-releases. That was the first time I played Res in VR, and I put on the full-on crazy synesthesia suit that they had brought with them, and that was fucking cool. I pretty much went, did that, and then left. I don't think I saw like one other thing, but the only reason I came into PSX that year was like, I'm going to go wear the crazy Res suit and play Res, absolutely, and then I'm going to go home. But yeah, it'd be very easy to see this as being like, hey, we've got a few demos of things that are right around the corner, and you can check it out. But it just doesn't really seem. My guess is that, you know, if you're going into this expecting to see a ton of unreleased video games, this just doesn't really seem. This is probably not going to be that type of show. This is going to be more of a public facing, sort of thing. And I'll be very curious to see how that goes and how that goes down and if people are excited about it. And, you know, because again, like they'll focus on like, hey, we've put all this together. It's like almost like they're bringing part of the theme park on tour, where they're like, oh, yeah, I don't know. We'll have a guy dressed up like Mario and you take pictures with him. You don't have to go all the way to Universal Studios or whatever to do that. So yeah, but I don't know, that's a cool move on their part. It kind of, I think, fills in some of the picture as to, you know, what do hardware manufacturers want to do in terms of a public show, but also in terms of like, how do they handle their announcements? And we'll see, like, do they, Do they decide to load up their stage show with a bunch of announcements? Again, I have to imagine not. I have to imagine that they'll have a Nintendo Direct 2 weeks before this or something, or, you know, or whatever. And then maybe there'll be a TV running that Direct on a loop somewhere on the show floor that you can go look at, or something like that. Right. But this just, again, this to me says like, this seems like you'll go here and play Mario Kart with people, which I, you know, hey, you could do that right now from the comfort of your own home. But I bet that's what they do. Come watch a Splatoon tournament. That's what this will be. Maybe they'll begrudgingly do a Smash Brothers thing here. I don't know. Maybe they don't do a Smash Brothers thing here, because like, if they want to have tournaments, but like, they don't want to have, they want people that attend this show to have bathed recently. So, you know, they probably don't do a Smash Brothers thing here. Let's see. This story comes to us from Kotaku. This is kind of a long time coming. It's maybe not, it's not the hugest surprise, but also it's a bummer. Microsoft has locked down the ability to run RetroArch, which is an emulation front end, on the Xbox Series X and S in retail mode. Now, what that means is, you know, the Microsoft Store is like relatively open in terms of what you can submit and run, and then you can share links with other people that can then download your private app. It's not that RetroArch was on the store in a fully official capacity and then they're taking it down. It's more that people were taking copies of RetroArch and compiling them and then putting them, like naming them weird things and then making them not fully released on the store so they would get an extra level of scrutiny, but being like a thing, well, I can share files. There'd be like Discord servers you could get on and be like, hey, share me the link that I can install RetroArch on my Xbox. And all along the way, there were clauses in Microsoft's terms that said we do not allow emulation software on our store. So these retail versions of the software would get hit and taken offline, and you'd be unable to update it, but you'd still probably be able to run it. They have gone an extra step further, and when they detect that, hey, those things are available on Xbox, they now block them from running. They've basically blocked the executables in a more direct way. I guess this started as of April 6th. And, you know, it's led to some of the folks who kind of have been shepherding those kind of shareable retail friendly versions of, and by retail, I mean your console as is, not modified, running in retail mode. If you remember, every Xbox is a dev kit, right? And so you can have it in retail mode or in dev kit mode. And so people didn't want to have to swap to dev kit mode. And so they would seek out, you know, somewhat shady. I mean, it's not, you know, I don't think there's anything really to worry about that much. To worry about when it came to downloading someone's compile of RetroArch on an Xbox. The Xbox is, you know, I doubt someone could compile software that would then steal your credit card. But hey, I don't know. I don't know how much of a security risk it is, but generally speaking, installing code on any device that you don't know where it came from and it came from a weird source, not always the best of ideas in the first place. So it's a weird thing. So now basically you get an error code and says like, hey, this is what is the error code that the person that was doing this says, the game or app you're trying to launch violates Microsoft Store policy and is not supported. And so this all, basically what this does is make people have to jump through a hoop. Also, in order to access dev mode on your Xbox, you have to pay a one-time fee. In the United States, that's $20. I think if you are in Turkey, it's like $3 or something. You know, there's exchange rates at play there. But for a one-time fee of $20, you can unlock that dev mode on your console. And then you can download and compile and run whatever the fuck you want on it. And you could still be doing all of this stuff that way. So the thing they're cracking down on is the thing they've always said was against the rules. They just didn't always enforce it all that well because people were trying to hide it and people were deliberately trying to name the apps weird things to get around store policies. And so it's interesting, like one of the people that was responsible for this is like on Twitter saying, now we've got no choice but to, you know, and he's like adding the Xbox account and adding Phil Spencer and saying, hashtag let us emulate. They still are. You just have to do it in dev mode. It's not, they're not blocking any functionality really. They're just kind of closing a loophole, and you know full well that you were using a weird loophole to spread this thing around to different consoles. I don't have a ton of sympathy for this because, again, this seems like it was something they were always trying to stay one step ahead of Microsoft's enforcement policies to begin with, and that Microsoft just stepped it up in a way that said, like, hey, we're spending a lot of time fucking playing whack-a-mole with different RetroArch variants, and it's annoying. We just kind of, is there a way we can like fucking just stop this? And they put tools in place to stop it more directly. And, but you know, you can still flip over to dev mode and still do what you want with an Xbox. And when you get all that stuff running on an Xbox, I have not jumped through those hoops myself because I have a zillion other devices that do that stuff. And I don't need it. But you can, you know, it's cool. The very idea that, like, your Xbox Series X is better at running PlayStation 1 and probably PlayStation 2 games than a PlayStation 5 is, is ridiculous, conceptually. But that's the situation, you know, and it'll run Dreamcast games quite well, and, you know, you can run GameCube games on it, and, you know, it's really quite good from the videos I've seen of how well it runs, and, you know, knowing generally the quality of the RetroArch cores, which some of them can be a little fucking all over the place, but the ones that are good are extremely good. You know, the idea that you could go download Xenia, the Xbox 360 emulator, compiled to run on an Xbox Series X, is wild. And I don't know if that's something that Microsoft cared about all that much in terms of like, oh no one's going to buy our backwards compatible games if people can go download XMU or Xenia on an Xbox. Like, you know, the hoops you have to jump through for that are still kind of substantial, and it's all stuff you can just do on a regular ass PC anyway. So it's not like, I don't know, like, you know, Microsoft, I think for all of its faults, it is pretty good at not living in a vacuum and not trying to pretend that the Xbox ecosystem exists in a vacuum. And so they seem a little more aware of just like, well, you can do this stuff on a PC. Why wouldn't we allow it here? And so, you know, them putting the blockade in place of like, yes, but we want to make sure that you're sandboxed off into dev mode if you're going to be running these unapproved apps and whatever else, I think that makes a ton of sense. I can't really fault them for that. And it doesn't seem like, I don't know, this does not strike me as a cash grab, them going like, well, we've got to get our $20. Like, I don't know. That it seems more like, hey, they would rather just make sure that this stuff is off to the side and running in a sandboxed environment and not running on the kind of retail mode thing. Some people have speculated like, oh, did they get pressure from Nintendo? Did they get pressure from other? Perhaps. I don't know. But like, again, this is all stuff that is easily doable on a PC and stuff you can still do on an Xbox if you jump through those hoops. They are not blocking you from flipping over to dev mode and doing dev mode things. So, I don't know. I don't know. Like, I don't know if that's something that rises up on Nintendo's radar high enough that they then go to Microsoft and go, hey guys, we think it's not cool that people are playing Super Mario Sunshine on an Xbox. And then the Xbox response, if I was there, would be like, yeah, we don't think it's cool people are playing Super Mario Sunshine in any way, shape, or form. We would love to block that. Fewer people should be allowed to play Super Mario Sunshine. We've got a great solution for it. Yeah, it's people were exploiting that loophole for a good long time, but this was something that would get, again, they were kind of playing whack-a-mole with it, where they'd be like, oh, we got online and we distributed the retail version of this, and then I got on Discord and sent the link to 1,000 people and they got it, and then it got shut down, but people can still run that version, and now I've got to do it all over again with an updated to make sure that everyone can get the updated version of RetroArch or whatever it is, you know, and have to jump through all those hoops. And oh, we needed to get an FTP client running on our Xbox so that we can copy the games over or run it off a USB drive or whatever else. So it's, yeah, I doubt this is, again, because they, if they wanted to put a full stop to it, they could block that stuff in dev mode too. And so this doesn't strike me as a situation. I mean, if you were a Nintendo, it, let's walk through this. Like, let's say, oh, Nintendo put pressure on Microsoft to stop this. Nintendo would not be satisfied with the answer of, oh, we've stopped it, unless people give us $20. That's not going to make Nintendo go, oh, great, awesome, thank you for solving that. They're going to go, no, this is still a problem, and now you're taking in money to enable people to do it? We really don't like this. They would still be unhappy with it. And so I do not think that this is something that is like, oh, Nintendo came to them and stopped them. The golden ideal couldn't happen because of this. You know, like there people are, I think, reaching on that. Like, was there a conversation had? Perhaps. I'd say maybe, you know, but again, this is not a solution. The dev mode solution is not something that is going to satisfy Nintendo if those conversations were truly being had. So, yeah, kind of, to me, that kind of blows a hole in that whole concept of that conspiracy. So, this to me just feels like almost like a manpower issue of, they're just like, we're so sick of fucking, like, we don't have enough people to enforce, like, you know, the actual store policies we're trying to enforce, because too many people have to spend time digging around shifty ass Discords, figuring out who's distributing RetroArch this week. And we would really rather just solve that problem and be done with it once and for all. Can we just do this and be done? And then they came up with a solution that does that. So yeah, you know, I think that, you know, these are good problems to have, because it means that the Xbox ecosystem is rather open, you know, and that they do kind of, the idea that they do allow people to enable dev mode and run weird stuff on an Xbox in the first place is pretty awesome. And I don't know, like, there should be some hoops to jump through with that, because that's a weird, dicey proposition to just, like, go download a bunch of unchecked code. You know, they want to maintain some security around stuff too, I'm sure. But yes, this Kotaku story, the process was like, yeah, like, so one way to get the emulators to last longer, this is what the Kotaku story, how they describe it, was to mark them as private and then whitelist specific users to be able to download them. And they were even running a Patreon to do this. And so you've got a weird thing where you're like, okay, now we're running a Patreon to distribute an app that we did not create to you. It's not like the RetroArch authors were doing this. It was like other people that were like running cottage businesses. I'm sure they're not making a ton of money off it, but like, you know, to whitelist people. The same way people sell access to dev firmware for Apple devices. Like, that used to be a thing where you're like, you go to a website, you know, normally Apple wants $100 a year, and now they have public betas. And so it's sort of a different, that they solved that problem by offering a public beta program. But if you wanted to run beta versions of iOS, you had to be licensed as a developer for $100 a year. And so, but if you paid that license, you could have, I want to say it was like 1,000 devices enrolled as developer devices. And so you would have people that would say, oh, I'll add your device to my list. Just pay me $20 or whatever else, you know? And so a lot of the websites that were devoted to doing that got served papers by Apple, and some of that stuff got shut down. But also then they just said, oh, fuck it. Let's just have a public beta that runs like a week behind the dev betas to give us time to kick tire. Like, if we're bricking devices, we'll know a week in advance before we roll it out to the public dev branch or whatever. So yeah, I don't know. This just to me falls right in line with that sort of stuff. And so yeah, they have a quote here from Gamer13, who is one of the people that did this. The crackdown started to ramp up around the end of summer going into autumn, where we dealt with daily takedowns for a while, so the day after they went up, they'd be taken down. We managed to find a way to get them to last up to 3 days since then by not naming them RetroArch and instead using randomized names. So, yeah. That's not... you know? Again, I'm sure on some level Microsoft just got fucking sick of dealing with it and came up with a different solution to it. Instead of having to, like, sit on this guy's Discord and going, what are they calling it this week? RetroArch with a number after it? Wow, that's a really intense secret. Wow, what are we going to do? So, yeah, I don't know. But, again, this is stuff that they've got dev mode for a reason. And this isn't even the reason they have dev mode, but you can do this in dev mode. So I don't know. I keep thinking about giving them their $20 and trying it. But again, the number of devices I have in this room that can run games of that class incredibly well is numerous. I've got this Steam Deck runs RetroArch quite well. This PC runs it even better. I've got LACA running on a fucking Raspberry Pi that's stuffed behind my TV that I'd never use, but it's there in case you need it. That does not run it as well as an Xbox would, but yeah. And I've got a Nintendo Switch around here somewhere that has all that installed on it. Where did that go? It's fine. I've got a 3DS that could probably run some of that stuff too, but I don't know. So I haven't felt the need to get the dev mode stuff to get it all up and running. It's awesome that you can do that. I think you should do it if you want to see that stuff. It's cool. If you happen to need a device that can run those games well, the Xbox Series X, even the Series S, quite good at emulating some of those games. And you can start getting retro achievements with them that way, which is fun. Let's see. Or, you know, hey, if you're on a PC, you could always just run BizHawk. BizHawk has retro achievement support now. It's a much more Windows-y kind of thing. If you don't need their big interface and front end and all that other stuff, BizHawk is really good. RetroArch is... there's a lot of baggage that comes with it. It's annoying. It's frustrating. There's been a leak, according to Video Games Chronicle, but also a bundle of other sites and Twitters and whatever else. Some footage, I guess, got out over the weekend of what appears to be a new Jet Set Radio game and a remake of Persona 3. This is this video got posted on Sunday, and it shows a little bit of footage of Persona 3 characters embroiled in combat in ways that look much higher res than actual Persona 3. And there was someone dug up a domain p3re.jp that appears that there's nothing there per se, but it has been registered by the same domain provider as the official Persona 5 Royal website. Which would, you know, potentially point to a Persona 3 remake. Gamatsu and some other sites are kind of saying, hey, the quote from Gamatsu that they have here, is it Gamatsu or Gamayas? I always thought it was Gamatsu. While we cannot verify the footage itself, Gamatsu understands that a Persona 3 remake has been in development at Atlas for several years. So, yeah, you know, there's a lot of other people kind of verifying bits and pieces around the edges of this. Of course, the Jet Set Radio news is not necessarily new. People have been talking about the notion of a new Jet Set game for kind of a while now. And that was like 2021. Okay, yeah. So some of this footage is apparently, according to the person who leaked the video on Twitter, the footage is from Sega Japan's internal meeting held in 2021. So who knows? Now we're 2 years removed from that. These games could have been canceled by then. They could be further in development. We have no idea. But yeah, you know, there seem to be some things kind of pointing to these, this being real. There's something about the idea of a new Jet Set Radio game that I love the idea of it. And then I don't know, man, when I go back and I play Jet Set Radio, the first game, not JSRF, though JSRF is kind of Jet Set Radio is an amazing, unparalleled stylistic achievement in video games for its day. Is enough qualifiers on the end of that to make that statement make sense? It never played especially well. It was not as fun or as awesome as it should have been. And JSRF is better in some ways, but this all makes me very happy to see what they would do with another Jet Set Radio now. And hopefully they would not just go, hey, the old games controlled like this, so we just did that. Because so many other games, you know, so many different games have come since then. JSRF, Jet Set Radio Future on the Xbox, went a long way to making that game much more playable and much more enjoyable. And I would love to see what they would do with it now, because hopefully it wouldn't just control like that. Hopefully we would see substantial updates and upgrades to how you move in that game and the sorts of trick system, the things you have at your disposal. I would just love to see more in a world where Tony Hawk came and went. You know, what level of influence could you place upon Jet Set Radio then, you know, or now, I guess, now that so much time has passed. And I hope that whatever they're doing just ends up having more of a modern feel to it, control-wise, but also to the objectives and the way a game is laid out and all of that. Every aspect of that game, I think you could do so much better than they did then. But again, I don't want to take away from the initial Jet Set Radio as like a fucking landmark video game. In terms of just style, so exemplary of the Dreamcast and what Sega was all about at that time. You know, what it was, Jet Set Radio, Space Channel 5, Rez. And maybe, you know, Sega Rally in Daytona, you know, some of the other Sega games of the era or whatever. But like, that I would love to see what they would do with that stuff now. And yeah, of course, we also have Bomb Rush Cyberpunk on its way as well. And I'm very much looking forward to seeing how that pans out. I guess what I'm saying is I think it would be very easy to put out a Jet Set Radio game that ends up adhering a little too closely to that original first game in a few too many ways, and it ends up being underwhelming. It would be very easy for them to do that. And so I hope that's not the case. I saw some folks, as far as the Persona footage is concerned, I think a Persona 4 remake makes a ton of sense. And it sounds like, you know, there are other outlets out there kind of saying, hey, yes, we've heard that this is happening. I saw a couple other folks looking at the footage and saying, you know what? This kind of looks like that mobile game. This kind of looks like, P5X or Slayer. No, not Slayer's X. I mean, the Persona mobile game that is, I guess, a gacha game. The Persona 5, the Phantom X. The Phantom Cross? The Phantom X. I don't know. Saying that the animations looked a little bit like that, and then wondering, like, hey, is this just a crossover for the gacha game or something? Hopefully that's not the case, but it's hard to say. And yes, you know, Bloomberg reported back a while ago that, you know, that Jet Set Radio and Crazy Taxi were undergoing, that were the subjects of like big budget reboots, which is crazy. I those games feel so of their era, and a Crazy Taxi especially. You know, Crazy Taxi's an arcade game, and Crazy Taxi on the Dreamcast, it's cool that they put in the original modes, or they put in the other modes where it's like, hey, just go for 10 minutes, go for 5 minutes, go for, you know, like the trying to do, but though that game, Crazy Taxi, is a game that's very much stuck in that pit of, we make arcade games, but no one goes to arcades anymore, so now we make home games. How do we do that? And, you know, you end up with games that have timers in them, driving games that have countdown timers in them. It's like, oh, you didn't reach the checkpoint, you don't get to finish the race. Like, that was always my problem with Crazy Taxi on the Dreamcast, was like, it's just, it felt too stuck to that original arcade game. And, you know, of course they made two more of them, and then they took, you know, they experimented in different directions. But I guess what I'm saying is, a Crazy Taxi, when we think about Crazy Taxi in modern terms of what does Crazy Taxi look like in 2024, it's such a dramatically, it had better be a dramatically different video game structurally than those initial games. Because if they just make another arcade game, and it's like, all right, you got to get to the Pizza Hut, and oh, that gets you more time on your timer, so you got to do this. Like, I don't want to do that. I do not want to do that. I do not want to have like that type of arcade. Like, those are the bad arcade experiences, I'll say. You know, when they try to carry those types of games forward in time, it was always very hard, and they always had to try to add a lot. And so yeah, when you think about that as a big budget reboot, are they making a GTA size city and then making it more mission based and removing the timers, and, you know, like what is that game? If you had to sit down right now today and say, let's make a new Crazy Taxi that is a big budget game and thus appeals to modern sensibilities, what is that? Because the original Crazy Taxi was meant to be experienced 10 minutes at a time. You know? So what do you do? You make an idle game. You make a clicker. That Crazy Taxi game that they put out on phones was surprisingly good. And the writing was fun. So yeah, I don't know. Again, this is supposedly footage from 2021. So it is hard to attach it to modern era and go, well, these games are definitely still in development. Anything could have happened between then and now. We do not know. So I would assume they are still on it. I would assume that we will still see a new Jet Set Radio, and thus we will eventually see a new Crazy Taxi as well, and that this Persona 3 thing seems like it's probably pretty legit. And it makes a ton of sense for them to remake Persona 3 anyway. So we will have to wait and see how all that stuff how all that stuff comes together, I guess. I don't know. Joe Staten has left Microsoft. He was the former director of Halo. Obviously, he left and went to Bungie and then came back at some point, and now he has left again. He was at 343 for a time, and then a story broke that he had left, which then he had to respond and say, yes, I am indeed leaving Microsoft. I'll have more info to share soon, but for now, I'd just like to thank all my Xbox colleagues for all their understanding and support as I embark on a new adventure. He had most recently been on the publishing side of Xbox, I believe. Is that what his most recent title was there? I'm trying to see what was his title. Senior Creative Director for Xbox Game Studios Global Publishing. And that put him out. He was on Halo Infinite. And so you know, Halo Infinite has not exactly gone well. So is this something where, as part of riding the ship, because obviously 343 did see some layoffs in that last round of layoffs, is this them? Did heads have to roll over the way Halo Infinite went down? I don't know. I don't have the answer to that question, but when you think about the kind of slam dunk that a new Halo and free-to-play multiplayer and some of this other, like the quality of that multiplayer is quite high. You know, when you think about how that went, do you then have to sit down and go like, okay, we need new leadership across the board because it's not happening. You know, you can blame a lot of stuff on the pandemic, of course. That obviously had a huge impact, but is this part of them going, okay, we've got to get some fresh blood in these roles and try a different approach. We got to move on or something to that effect. Like, I don't know. Regardless, it sounds like he has his next steps in mind, at least from what he posted here. So I don't think this is a situation where someone rolled up on him and said like, get your shit, man. And let him go. That's, you know, but he does say, he's thanking them as he embarks on a new adventure. So the implication there is that he's got a next step lined up and maybe we'll hear about it in the relatively near future. But yeah, as a head of creative for Halo Infinite, and then as you look at the situation Halo Infinite has been in where they have been unable to fully dig it out of the trench that it fell into. I'm certainly not going to pin that on anyone. I don't know how they worked over there. This isn't me saying that the leadership fumbled, you know, that that's their fault. I can only speculate here. He was the head of creative for Halo Infinite, a game that has had a very troubled run. And even as they have taken big steps and fixed a lot of things, hasn't really reached a point where people go like, oh, okay, they've fixed it. This is a great game now. It feels like every update that comes out, there's still this like undercurrent of like, yeah, this is maybe not enough. This has still got some problems. We've still got a situation here. We've still got more work to do. Like they haven't cleared it. They have not shaken off the baggage, shaken off the funk that game has accumulated since its release, which is a shame because, again, I think that when they launched, like I said, the year that game came out, Halo Infinite was the best game I played that year. I thought that was a really fun campaign. The multiplayer is really good, but you can't call a game Halo Infinite and talk about how you're talking about the next X number of years of Halo and then have your content pipeline completely fall apart in terms of updates to the game, in terms of fixing problems. Like it's just been saddled with so many things to the point where they're like, hey, yeah, we're, you know, like the talk is like, nah, we're gonna move to Unreal Engine, we're gonna take this tech, throw it in the fucking bammer, we're done, and start to work on something else or whatever it is. So in that transition, it makes sense that would be a good time for people to look at their career, look at them and go like, okay, do I want to sign up for the next 5 years of Halo and go through this engine transition and all this other stuff? Nah, I think I'm good. I think I've got other things I want to accomplish in my life and maybe step away. So, I'm not trying to throw shade in any direction here because obviously the last few years have been very fucking hard on game development. But at some point you've got to move on. At some point you've got to figure out what's next and try to get there. And when you get to those pivot points of, okay, here's what we're doing next, it's a natural time for people to want to move on or a natural time for the organization to want to make changes. So, cool. I very much would be interested in seeing what Joe Staten does next. I think he has always struck me as an incredibly passionate person who, you know, when his days at Bungie under Destiny had very grand ideas of what Destiny should be and how Destiny should be in ways that I don't think Destiny ever realized. And I don't know if Destiny would have been a better game had it realized that. I think Destiny is a game that they probably at some point had to reel in and be like, okay, this game needs to ship. But I believe I think he gave the speech about the pre-release of Destiny 1. I went up to Bungie, and a lot of the talk was about every gun has a story, you know, and that player stories matter, and how did you do this, and what, and that every, you know, the idea that you've got, like, oh, where'd you get that weapon? And you've got, like, well, we were doing this, and this happened, and this. The reality of it is, like, oh, it's on the loot table for the raid, and so I ran the raid once a week, every week, until it finally fucking dropped. You know, like, that's the story that goes with most Destiny guns, you know? But like that vision of player stories that matter is good. Like that is, you know, if you could actually nail that, then that's a magical place for players to be. You know, if players can come away from your game with, like, and I think Battle Royale games, weirdly enough, have been a great source of player stories. A great source of compelling player stories, I guess I should say. Of like, oh man, we were fucking holed up in this house and these guys fucking drove up and they did this and we did, and we fucking jumped around them and did this and this cool shit. And I can't believe we fucking made it. And then I ran over this ridge and I got shot in the fucking face and we lost. And, you know, like the tales of brutal loss are sometimes just as good as winning when it comes to some of these battle royales. And it's why those games are so clippable. It's why watching clips of them can be so fun. It's why proximity voice chat in Warzone is added another often disturbing dimension to these player stories. But doing that in a loot game, if you could do it, that would be amazing. But to do that, every gun would have to seem different. And it wouldn't be just a situation of just like, oh, you got the exotic, huh? You got the exotic out of the raid? Did you get a good roll on it? No? Fuck. I guess we'll keep running it then. Like, those are the player stories in Destiny 2. Is we looked at the loot table, or, oh, I logged in on the weekend and this guy was selling it. And so I went and gave him some shards or whatever. And that's not to say Destiny is bad because of that. That's how loot games work. Like, that's, you know, the gulf between having every gun have a story and the reality of a shipping live game that you're trying to update all the time, that's massive. It's a massive gulf to get from here to here. And so it's not surprising that they did not reach that goal of you know, the guns having a story and so on and so forth. But I love that. If not that exact concept, I love that that's something that he seemed very passionate about. And I would love to see more people chasing those sorts of weird game dev dreams of finding more ways to make that real, of finding more ways to, and it doesn't have to be guns. It doesn't have to be an item per se, you know, because the player stories that come out of a battle royale are rarely about like, I found an MP5, you know, it's like, I got my loadout and then we did this. So, you know, it's not about the items, but the idea of a role-playing game, be it, you know, action RPG, you know, Destiny is an action RPG, right? I mean, the idea of being able to look at a player and go like, man, like back in the World of Warcraft days, it was like, oh shit, that dude's got sick pauldrons. Where did you get your sick pauldrons? And the answer was always like, oh, I don't know, Burning Steps. You know, whatever fucking, wherever it was that we got our pauldrons from back in the day. But before you had your pauldrons, you saw players with pauldrons and you went, oh shit, okay, yeah. They're good. Like that whole thing of like looking at a player and knowing that they've been through some shit is an amazing idea. Unfortunately, the way games are monetized these days is another wrinkle on top of that, right? Where now everyone wants to transmog everything. Now everyone wants to buy, you know, they're selling cosmetics. And so you look at a character and go like, oh, your Master Chief has cat ears. What's the story behind that? And you're like, I had $7. Cool story. You know? So it's kind of hard to, the cosmetic nature of microtransactions and stuff actually, I think, makes that goal even more difficult to see, you know? So it's, that story did stick with me from the Destiny days. In good ways and in bad ways, right? Because you play Destiny and you're like, that's not what this game is at all. You're like borderline lying to people. But like, you know, but I think you look at it and go like, well, yeah, that probably was the goal at some point. But then you think about how games actually get made and shipped and the reality of updating content and putting things out on a regular basis and whatever, you know, you're like, okay, yeah. Yeah. I guess you see why that would be, if not impossible, very difficult to achieve. So I'd be interested in seeing what he does next, assuming that he still has a passion for that sort of stuff and a passion for that sort of lore. I think his name has been associated with some amazing moments in video games over the years, and so we'll see where he ends up next and what he does next. What else? There's kind of a lot of news this week. Harada has confirmed that Tekken 8 will have crossplay and rollback netcode. This is where I hit the. This is where I find buttons to press in an excited way. That's not the button. Come on, gamers, get crazy! All right, yeah, that'll work. This is exciting. I think, you know, crossplay is such a more normalized thing than it was when Tekken 7 was coming out. So he actually. The reason why this is a story, and Video Games Chronicles recapped this, Jordan Midler over there, when he revealed, hey, it's going to have crossplay, he also said, hey, I tried to do this last time too, basically. When the previous generation consoles were released, I had already proposed crossplay between the two platformers. I assume it just means platforms. However, at that time, they were at odds with each other over their mutual interests and P2P security issues and repeatedly refused. Harada went on to then tweet, while there are still some problems left with implementing crossplay, it will be implemented in the game. Oh, he's not even saying that these are problems on his part. Remember when they announced they were open to crossplay a few years ago, but in reality, they didn't actively support third parties at the time and the hurdles were actually quite high? There are still some problems left, but it will be possible. These are largely Sony-related issues, if I, remember correctly. From the days when crossplay was coming out, Sony was the one that stepped in and said no, and then Sony cooked up a big, long document that was like, okay, here's how you can, if you want to do crossplay, here's how we get paid. And it was, you know... it was a situation where if X number of hours of total hours are spent on PlayStation platforms, they get paid regardless of the platform where the cosmetics were purchased. There's, you know, some kind of weird math formula for how Sony gets paid no matter what, that developers were like, this sucks. What are you talking about? And yeah, some of that stuff, that was all stuff we had heard beforehand, but then when a ton of documents started getting dropped in the Epic lawsuit with Apple, I think those formulas and a lot of those details kind of came out in those disclosures, kind of confirming pretty much what we knew all along. It sounds like I'm sure some of those situations, some of those hurdles do still exist in some way, shape, or form. It's not as quite as easy as just Sony going like, yeah, man, just do it. But it's something that more and more games are doing. Even huge games like Call of Duty that make a lot of money on cosmetics, they're willing to jump through those hoops. And maybe they get preferential treatment by being Call of Duty. Maybe they won't get it for long. Who knows? And yes, Sony's back end is probably still some kind of weird nightmare on top of all that. So who knows what you have to do to make all that work. That's just exciting nonetheless. That's crossplay should be everywhere it can be, whenever it can be. That's, you know, as a player of video games, when I want to play an online video game, I want to do it with strangers, and I can only do that if other players are playing the game. So anything you can do to ensure the maximum number of players that I can find when I enter matchmaking, the better. And I don't want to be in a situation where it's like, and this is not how it would go. It'd probably go the other way, if anything. But like, let's say you buy the PlayStation version of Tekken 8, but everyone else bought it on Xbox, and you're like, shit, I'm hitting quick match. This is Windjammers 2, by the way. Kind of went through this by virtue of it being on Game Pass. The only people playing Windjammers 2 were doing so on the Xbox platforms of PC and Xbox. But then I don't think the Steam version of Windjammers 2 was piped into that same matchmaking. And I don't believe the PlayStation version, it did not have proper crossplay. And so if you were on a PlayStation trying to play Windjammers 2 online, you couldn't. That's, you know, unless you had a friend who was playing it, then obviously you could do that. And occasionally you would match with some other folks, but it was not like there was never an abundance of players playing it. In that situation, crossplay helps with those issues. And it's better for everyone. That's better for Xbox players. That's better for PlayStation players. Like, the ability to find players and play with them. There's no downside to that. Unless you're doing business on the back end and then you're like, well, what if you bought what if you bought Nina's wedding outfit and then you bought it on Xbox and you want to play it with it on PlayStation? We don't get our cut then. And how do we get our cut? What about our cut? Which is a valid concern. Everyone wants their cut, but as a player, annoying when games fuck that up. I wish that they would narrow down some kind of release window for Tekken 8. Because they sure are spending a ton of time talking about Tekken 8. And then we're like, is this game not coming out until next year? Or what's the deal? because they still have to do their location tests and whatever else. Like, it's just that there's so much detail out there. And they've put out so many character trailers already. They've paused it for a bit. Because this is probably characters that will appear in whatever beta or location test or whatever they end up doing. But boy, it sure seems like we know a lot about Tekken 8 for a game that doesn't even technically have a release window whatsoever. They've talked about systems, they've talked about how the gauges work, like all of this stuff. And so yeah, maybe they're waiting for Mortal Kombat news to drop and all that. Because, like, you know, yeah, there's no harm in saying when your game is going to come out, even, you know, like people are saying, oh, what if maybe they're waiting for Street Fighter 6 to release. Like, we already know when it's going to release. Like, announcing a release date or even a release window, I don't think helps or hurts them in that specific way, right? So I don't know. Let's see. Gamescom Opening Night Live will return this August. We talked all about E3 and the lack thereof last week, and the Summer Games Fest, which is an event that will happen in a similar window, and you know, we'll kind of compile some game announcements together into both one live event, but also some individual publisher and hardware maker streams. We will also have a live show in August that will coincide with Gamescom. The German trade show, open to the public. I'm told it smells bad in there on the public days, but I've never gone myself. I would love to go someday, but not this year. This will happen on the 22nd of August. Jeff Keighley, who has hosted the show, has confirmed that. And that's pretty much all we know, is that there will be another event like that. So this is kind of ends up bookending the summer release, like game news season, right? The Summer Game Fest, I guess, will theoretically open that up, and it will close with Gamescom, generally speaking. You'll still have Tokyo Game Show in September, you know, some other stuff there. But yeah, I don't know. We'll see. This is the Gamescom live show has always had a handful of things that are interesting, but because it happened so long after E3, Gamescom always was kind of a second tier event. You're like, okay, like if you're a fighting game, for example, you might announce the game at E3 and then go to Gamescom and say, we've got two new characters to unveil right now. And then you would have, but those would also be the same characters that you would unveil at Comic-Con, because that was what helped, because Mortal Kombat would be at Comic-Con, or, you know, whatever. Well, Injustice, obviously. So Gamescom always had that kind of like lower tier of importance compared to E3. In a world where there is no E3 anymore, my gut tells me that the June timeframe will still be when we hear most of our news, but there will still be some things. You know, we'll get an hour of Farming Simulator talk on Gamescom opening night live, as well as who knows what else, right? So yes, that will happen. And so that's kind of like continuing to fill in that kind of summer time frame when it comes to the different bits of news. Dreams are dead. Dreams are over. We're done with dreams. We are no longer dreaming. We are cutting off dream. That's it. We're going to dream all summer long. And then September 1st, no more dreams. That's not strictly true. Media Molecule has announced plans to, well, they've got some updates left for Dreams. Remember the PlayStation 4 thing they made, Dreams? And it came out as like a beta, and then they sold it, and then it was like they've been updating it a lot, and it never quite caught on, really. September 1st will be the end of live support for Dreams. They have some updates that are still in the works, but they are going to make a lot of changes to the game around that time to kind of future-proof it in a way. This isn't about them shutting down servers per se. In fact, they're doing a server migration that seems like it will be focused on finding ways to make sure that people's creations are still there for the foreseeable future. You know, that to me, that kind of says there's maybe another shutoff down the line, but we'll see. You'll be able to continue to play, create, and share Dreams with others after September, but we won't be releasing any more updates to the game or events such as DreamsCom, All Hallows Dreams, or the Impy Awards. We are incredibly proud of the work we've done in developing Dreams, such as our content releases, create updates, and live events, and we're endlessly grateful to the community for their belief and continuous contributions since launch. And they say that they are working on a new project that they are not getting into at all. But yeah, then they get into their server migration. We're preparing to migrate to our new server in late May. The complexity of this work has meant we've had to make changes, as not every feature in Dreams has been compatible with the needed modifications to the server. This is weird. Below, you'll find all the major changes coming with Dreams' new server. And so some of this is file size limits. Each user will have 5 gigs of online storage space to store their Dreams creations in. They will be able to store 256 photos and 512 versions of each creation. So that's, it sounded like they maybe did not have a limit per se prior to that, but they are kind of instigating this in probably a way to make the costs manageable for the foreseeable future. Like, okay, we can have 5 gigabytes of space for everybody. It'll cost us this much to keep it running, and thus we can keep it running, is probably how that works. We are removing archiving as a feature. Creations that were archived prior to the date of the server migration will be unarchived and available in your saved creations, where you can choose to delete them. We've simplified release screens, making it easier for you to publish your dreams creations. We've improved clarity for versions. A global local version limit is called out where it wasn't previously. We've named the two key versions latest online and lead. We're removing prize bubbles from dreams. Please make private prizes public if you'd like to fellow players to use them. Specifically, creations that included prizes in bubbles will now display empty bubbles. You will no longer have access to this feature from the gadgets menu. So they're like, they're removing some trophies from the game and adding some new trophies so that players can still get a platinum trophy. They're removing Twitch integration. They are temporarily removing the audio importer, but expect to have it back before October. So like kind of a lot of, this sounds like a very dramatic back end change. It's not necessarily clear that like the idea that like, hey, we're doing a server migration, and some of the things that we used to be able to allow are not going to be allowed anymore is a weird one. It's like, oh, well, maybe you should migrate to a better server. I imagine it's something that they're doing in order to make the game sustainable, again, for the foreseeable future. That's my guess. Activity feeds. You will no longer be able to view what another player has been doing via the other player's activity feed. Scoreboards will only show the top 100 entries. We are removing friend scoreboards. You will not see PSN friend score comparisons. That sounds like they had to store a ton of data for scoreboards for things that people probably haven't touched in a year or more. And so limiting that, yeah, sure. Home spaces are now local only. You cannot visit other users' home spaces. Linking to creations and players by ID in titles and descriptions will no longer be possible. You will not be able to open a creation in-game from the InDreams website. Taking photos is now limited to a maximum of 15 photos before saving. They're going to take the trial version down. And yeah, we're currently working on a new project that we're not ready to talk about at this stage, but stay tuned for more information in the future. Why have you decided to end live support? We're very proud and grateful. Whilst we've always had the desire to build on the foundation of dreams and expand the experience, when reviewing our plans, we were not able to define a sustainable path. We made the decision to change the studio product strategy. This is obviously disappointing to many people inside and inside outside of Media Molecule. However, we are incredibly excited for what will come next. We may deploy critical bug patches after September. You will still be able to purchase the game. Media Molecule is working on a new project. We are not ready to talk about this yet. We can confirm that it is not Dreams 2 or the Dreams IP. So there's that. It will not come to PlayStation 5. It will not come to PSVR 2. So that is all stuff that they are kind of walking away from. And I think that makes sense. I can't, you know, like, again, Dreams never... I feel like Dreams never met its full potential. I feel like the initial announcement of Dreams and what Dreams seemed to be capable of, they never really found a great way to surface that to players, to a wider audience, to, you know, you would see news stories and wrap-ups of people going like, look at this crazy thing someone made in Dreams. Someone made a Legend of Zelda game in Dreams, or whatever it was. But that was never enough to get people to buy Dreams. And so I think if they took the Dreams creation and found ways to get those out of Dreams or get those to be things that people could experience without having to purchase Dreams, that might be more enticing and getting players to experience that stuff. And if you had more players out there playing the Dreams creations, that then those players might be enticed to buy Dreams. It just felt like Dreams never got its day in the sun. It felt like they put it out. Obviously, the Media Molecule has been updating it for a good long time. And in some ways, I'm surprised that they did it this long. You know, is it a situation where the creation tool set should have been available for close to free, but then playing the games cost more, or vice versa? You know, you pay for the creation tools, but people can play your stuff for free so that you're enticed to make things. I there's stuff about the business end of it. You know, like, obviously, they had PlayStation Move support for sculpting and all this other stuff. And, you know, there's, but at the same time, would it have been better served appearing on PC, where players could have had an easier time importing things and sculpting things and whatever else? Like, would that have helped? Probably. But would it have helped enough? Like, those are the sorts of things you have to then look at. And is Dreams really going to catch on and be a big deal ever? I think the answer was always no. And I think it could have done better than it did, but I don't know that it was ever going to, you know, look at the games with creation tool sets right now that are really big, right? Roblox, Fortnite, like that sort of stuff. Like, Dreams was never in that conversation. Not that it needed to be, but, yeah, I don't know. It always just felt like, it never felt like Dreams actually came out. Because they when they did release it, it was like, this is a beta, and we're not putting the single player content in it for a while. And then they kept updating it and kept updating it. But it always felt like there was something missing. Like, there's some big push of like, look at Dreams, and you know, websites would do that. They would be like, look at this video we made of these crazy things in Dreams, or look at these screenshots. Here's the top 10 things that we found in Dreams. You know, you could do listicles and videos about the cool shit in Dreams, and you know, people did that. But Sony never did it. Media Molecule had a team in place, and they put on events for their community and did a lot of stuff there. But all of that stuff felt like it was very focused at players that were already in the ecosystem. And so it just never really felt like there was a touch point for players that weren't already interested in that concept to get interested, if that makes sense. And it just feels like that everyone involved, you know, Sony could have pushed it a lot harder, I think. But that's a hard, you know, how do you push it? It's such a weird thing. What's the right way to market it? How do you get the, you know, like, it's not as easy as like, they should have put money into marketing it. Like, yeah, but like, how do you do that? Like, how do you build the tool sets, or how do you build the product in such a way that it's very low touch and very low friction for an interested player to see the cool shit in Dreams? And should they have to pay for that? Or do you sell a subset of Dreams that's the Dreams viewer that doesn't have the creation tools but lets you play things that people have created? You know, what do you do to the product to get more players interested and excited about what's happening there? Because excitement drives that whole thing. More players will create cooler shit if players are actually playing them. But if you're just making it for the, like, however many hundreds of players are out there also still remembering that Dreams exists and still making their own stuff, then it's just, you're just kind of showing it off to each other and going like, look at this cool shit. And going like, oh yeah, that's cool. My shit is also cool. And you go, oh, that's cool shit too. All right, awesome. What'd you make? Oh, I made a pumpkin thing. You shoot it. Oh, I made a pumpkin thing too. You jump over it. Nice. It just, it never felt like it got the chance it deserved. But also, I'll say, I don't know that that product was ever going to, you know, it was never going to reach Roblox numbers, right? However much you marketed it, I don't think that they would have ever gotten to that point. For better or worse. I, you know, like, not everything has to be that big, but I think if you're looking at, like, what's the potential in that sort of space of creating things and user created content and sharing that stuff around. They just never figured out a distribution method. They never figured out how to get people's eyes on it. And they never put it out on PC, which I think would have helped. But that's Sony for you. I don't know. They do put some things out on PC now, but at the time the Dreams was coming out, it was not really a big push. And so some features that they had talked about, or at least like had on their roadmap, are now not happening. They said, hey, you know, the questions in their FAQ are, will multiplayer or PS5 or PSVR 2 or 3D printing support come to Dreams? No. The planned releases for Dreams do not include multiplayer, PlayStation 5, PSVR 2, or 3D printing support. There will be an update to animation and create mode and Tren. And then the follow-up is, but multiplayer was on your Trello board. What happened? Like, while we have done research and development on many areas for Dreams, unfortunately, we're not able to bring those features to the game. So, yeah. What is the point of the server migration and changes if the live service is discontinuing? We still want to allow people to create in Dreams in a secure way. So the server work is a technical update to assure the stability of the Dreams server. That makes sense. Especially when you look at the problems that Little Big Planet experienced with hackers and people breaking that game, like them taking precautions to shore up that support and make sure that it is something they can support with critical bug fixes down the line. And also probably cut some costs along the way. Makes a ton of sense. Makes a ton of sense. But I guess pour one out for Dreams. I don't know. It felt like Dreams never came out. It still feels like we're waiting for Dreams to happen. In a way. Last story, Super Mario Brothers, the movie, this did really well. they made a lot of money. They made a lot of money and they have broken some records along the way. According to the Hollywood Reporter. It is the biggest worldwide opening of all time for an animated film, passing the global debut of Frozen 2, which is a terrible movie. Super Mario is the fourth highest grossing animated title of the pandemic era, with Universal claiming all four spots, with Minions: The Rise of Gru, Puss in Boots: The Last Wish, and Sing 2. And they say, at this rate, Mario could be the first billion-dollar grosser of 2023. Yeah, they're saying that it's... gosh. $375 million worldwide, which is the best showing of the year to date on all fronts. It's the second biggest domestic opening of all time for an animated film. Passing Finding Dory. I don't know what that is. That's a Pixar film, apparently. Is that the one about the fish? Is that a fish movie? Is that a fish movie? That's going to be my new question about any movies. Renfield. Is that that fish movie? And it is second only to Incredibles 2 on the list of top weekend debuts. It is the second biggest international opening of all time for an animated film, second only to Frozen 2. It is the biggest opening of all time for a video game adaptation. So that is that means they passed Sonic the Hedgehog 2, which had a 3-day domestic of 72.1 million. Which, you know, for the time was probably a big deal. It was also the biggest global opening of any video game adaptation because it beat Warcraft. Remember Warcraft? Remember they made a Warcraft movie? Sonic 2 had a staggered international rollout, making comparisons impossible. So there's that too. It's the biggest opening of the year to date. That means it did better than Ant-Man and the Wasp: Quantumania. It's the top opening in Illumination's history. It is the fourth biggest global day and date opening in Universal history. That means it is fourth. So the only movies that have done better are Furious 7, Jurassic World, and Fast 8, The Fate of the Furious. I didn't know that was the full title of that movie. I forgot. It's the top 5-day domestic opening for a Wednesday to Sunday launch, beating Transformers: The Revenge of the Fallen, and is the top animated opening of all time for IMAX. People's takes on the movies, the movie itself, feel like they are extremely all over the place. This was interesting because everything I had heard from folks who had been to some of the early screenings, people who worked in and around video games and some other folks were like, yeah, it's awesome. It's really well made. It's a really, you know, like, I heard nothing but positivity. And then when like the review embargo hit and like film critics started weighing in on it, they just kind of started shitting all over it. And now that the movie is out there and people are seeing it, I feel like I'm seeing a very, like, I guess, healthy mix of opinions, where some people are like, this is the most soulless movie I've ever fucking seen. And people saying this is an incredible, like, frenetic mess of a movie and I love it. It sounds like that they just kind of turned it. I don't know. It sounds like it doesn't have much of a story, but you could say that about the Super Mario Brothers video games, and that it's just like them rolling out nonstop references and Easter eggs and stuff, like, you know, references to other, you know, the parts of the Mario lore, as well as, you know, some other Nintendo stuff here and there. Which, I don't know, that sounds interesting. I don't, my daughter picked up, my daughter knows the names of all the Mario characters. And all she's done is played Mario Kart for the GBA and Mario Kart 7. And she has a friend who works at Nintendo sent us a Princess Peach puppet, and when she was born, sent us some stuff out of the Nintendo store, the employee store. So she's kind of had that stuff around her, but she never really took to it until getting into Mario Kart, and she wants to play Super Princess Peach, but she can't quite control it well enough. But she knows who Toad is. She definitely knows who Princess Peach is. She knows who Mario and Luigi are. It's crazy. She has had very little exposure to them overall. But she has absorbed that. And so I kind of want to take her to the movie. I kind of want to take her to see the movie. She has never been to a movie theater. And I don't know how she would handle it at, you know, 3.5. I say 3.5. She'll be 4 here pretty soon. Man, fuck. She'll be 4 here pretty soon. And so I don't know if she would like the movie theater experience. And I'm thinking of maybe waiting until it comes home, because she'll watch a movie here at home, no problem, because she doesn't have to pay full attention to it. She can, you know, do other stuff. She can color. She can be at her table coloring and have the movie on and all that other stuff. She knows that, but, like, you know, Frozen is her thing. And so she knows the names of the parents in Frozen and stuff. Like, she's got the Frozen lore fucking down cold, except for like the colonialism stuff. She knows all those characters. I think I might wait until it comes home and show it to her then. I will say I was investigating Kick, which is a streaming platform that, as far as I can tell, if I had to have a one-line description of Kick, it is a bunch of people who got banned from Twitch decided to start their own streaming site so that they could play gambling games and shake ass. A lot of just close-up shots of ass on Kick. I don't know if that's only at night or not, but hey, if that interests you, there you go. And they have a section of the website where it's like, it just says other. And I clicked on other because it was like the third most populated category by viewers. And it was just people in there streaming recent releases of movies. Like, there was just, including a channel that was just running a fucking, like, cam rip of the Super Mario Brothers movie on loop. And I know it looped because I watched the last 5 minutes of the Super Mario Brothers movie on Kick. And it ended how I thought it was. I feel like I watched that 5 minute chunk and learned everything I need to know about that entire movie. I mean, I'll see the whole movie at some point, but I just watched it and went like, huh, yeah, yeah. That checks out every little bit of this. Cause I was just clicking around. It's like, oh, this guy's just got Top Gun Maverick running. Not like on screen talking about it. Not like, hey, we're talking while we're watching the movie, which is still not legal, but like, hey, it was just full screen. No, just here you go. Just looping this movie. Like it was Vapors TV or something. Or like it was Twitch during the Super Bowl. I mean, you know, this stuff happens on Twitch, but you know, it, like, Twitch has come a long way in terms of, I don't know, figuring that shit out or whatever it is. But yeah, Kick is, it has, like, there's part of Kick that is exciting because it feels like this massive Wild West thing that a new platform has. But also, then you look at it and go, like, why are 50,000 people watching, like, this guy on some gambling website? Or, you know, like, are these views legit? Is this a legit service? And, you know, they're trying to lure streamers over there by saying, like, oh, it's 95% of your subscription money you get to keep. And, you know, the things a new business would do to try to compete with Twitch. And, you know, there are some people that I respect that started streaming on that website. And so that caused me to give it a look. And so I went and signed up for an account and everything there. And I just started looking at it more and more. I was like, this seems like it is, this seems shady. I'm not going to sit here and tell you that it's money laundering I'm not going to cast any kind of, you know, accusations in their direction. Just that the whole thing looks incredibly fishy to me. And I signed up for it because I was like, oh man, a new streaming platform. That might be fun. It's always fun when there's new shit. And you know, I miss Mixer. Bring back Mixer. Microsoft. Ugh. Yeah, it was just a weird, like, as I clicked around the site, I was like, man, this is like, what the heck? Like, there's like a whole section here that seems to be devoted to bootleg movies. And then you've got a whole section here that is like a light version of my free cams. but without the actual nudity, but then occasionally sometimes the nudity. There was one channel that was a guy like that seemed to have a stripper pole in his house and he was just yelling at this girl. I was just like, what the fuck is every click seemed like it was like I was just witnessing another strange crime. And I was like, I don't know what the fuck is going on here. Boy, oh boy. But hey, if you like seeing fucking ill shit, that website has it at the moment. I assume at some point the cops fucking descend on it and, you know, the DMCAs happen and whatever else. But, yeah, it's fucking, it's weird. Anyway, that's the news. Why don't we get into some emails? podcast@guard.bike is the email address. You can send in your emails to me, and I will read them, and some of them will appear on this show in voice form from me reading them out loud. Let's see here. Merlin from Ohio writes in and says, for the past 2 or 3 years, whenever Nintendo Directs and other narrated videos from Nintendo introduce a game, they call it the game name, instead of just saying that game's name. For example, A new expansion is coming to the Splatoon 3 game, or the Advance Wars 1 and 2 Reboot Camp game releases August 21st. Any idea what the rationale behind consistently using such odd language is? Does it annoy everybody else the same way it does me? I always just assumed that was a translation thing, because those directs are initially recorded in Japanese and then translated. Or the other thing is that they, but also, you know, like there's no reason not to localize that in a way that sounds sensible and native speaking, right? So the idea that they continue to do it is weird. But I guess I always thought of it as they are trying to provide very clear, not concise, very clear language as to what they're referring to at any given time. They're not referring to a bundle. They're not referring to DLC. They're referring to it as it is coming to the game. It is not coming to the voice chat app. It is not coming to the Switch, you know, hardware, you know, firmware, user icons. It, you know, like it just sounds like that they are trying to be as precise as they possibly can, in ways that it just, it's, yeah, it comes off as, I guess, mechanical. It comes off as like not natural sounding, but technically correct, I guess. But yes, I have noticed that. It is weird. I always just chalked it up to some mix of localization and some lawyer somewhere going like, let's refer to it as the game and do just some weird take on it there. Michael from Kansas City, Missouri writes in and says, are there any canceled games that have stuck with you over time or that you really wish had crossed the finish line? For whatever reason, two of the titles that frequently pop up in my head are Faith in a 45 and This is Vegas. I know many people mention StarCraft Ghost, but do any pop up for you from time to time? Echo Delta for the N64 is the one that I always think of. It's a game that was at Space World 2000. And I played it and wrote about it, and it was like a cool, cute little underwater vehicle adventure thing. And it wasn't particularly remarkable. It seemed like it would be cool. I remember playing it and going like, this seems neat. I would like to play more of this. And then it got canned. And that's one that always kind of comes up for me. I think reasons being what I had heard about it and how cool it maybe could have been. The canceled Pirates of the Caribbean game. Armada of the Damned that Propaganda was working on. I think I played that at a Disney event before it got canceled. And I remember it seeming like it could be cool. I'm not a Pirates of the Caribbean fan especially or any of that stuff, but their pitch was very interesting, and I remember the game seeming like it could be pretty cool in terms of open sea pirating and stuff. You know, like, I don't know, Assassin's Creed kind of made good on at least some aspects of that. That was like 2010, I want to say. Those are probably the two that first come to mind. Daddy Warbucks from the Discord writes in and says, last week you mentioned that games with a silent protagonist should have an explanation in universe for their silence. I wholeheartedly disagree. I think games should worry less about explaining why they feel like video games. Don't spin me some yarn about some pocket dimension bullshit to explain why I carry 17 swords. It's because it's a video game. Why do health packs work? Are there nanobots? No, it's just a fucking health pack, man. I added the fucking there for emphasis. You're welcome. When you canonize the game mechanics, it takes away from the world because the explanation is almost never satisfying or reasonable. Sometimes it can add to the game and lore, but most of the time you just roll your eyes and move on. Yeah, totally. I can get that. I don't know. But at the same time, I liked the idea when they came up with like, hey, why do the guns in Mass Effect have clips now? And they're like, oh, they're heat sinks. And when the heat sink gets used up, you got to throw it away and put in a new one. Like the... And they didn't throw that shit in your face. It was just there if you wanted to go look at it, right? But like when you dug into the lore of Mass Effect, it was like, this. I love that they came up with dumb descriptions for some of this shit. And that's fun sometimes too. As for speaking characters, I think different games, I think that's different than why you can carry 17 swords. You know? And I guess the thing I don't like is when they try to wink and nod at silent protagonists. You know what I mean? Like, it's clear that the character can... It's clear, Link can make noise. Link can vocalize. Yeah! Link can yell. But when they then go like, oh, the strong and silent type, huh? I fucking hate that shit. Because that feels like them trying to write, like, a line of dialogue that explains, like, why they didn't pay the money to, you know, actually do the work to voice the character. Or, you know, and that's an artistic choice, right? Like, that's... We live in a world where so many characters voice it. Are voiced now, you know, or every character around the silent protagonist can talk their ass off. And so, you know, I don't know, like you end up in, yeah. Or you end up in a situation where like you are making choices from a dialogue wheel or dialogue choice that implies that your character did say something, but then they don't speak. At that point, just fucking record the voice, you know, pick the thing and have Link go like, wow, where do I go to get firebombs? And then the Goron says like, I got that shit on lock, son. Sorry, I didn't mean to leak dialogue from the new Zelda game. They're going to hunt me down. They're going to hunt down my Discord ID and sue Discord. So, you know, it's touchy. I think there's, you know, when you make a character talk in text and then you choose to not record the voice, that to me feels... like a disconnect. You know what I mean? And the idea of the protagonist as blank slate so that you can kind of inject your own thoughts onto it, that makes a ton of sense. But at the same time, then don't write dialogue that implies that the character is speaking. I just can't hear it. That, I think, kind of sucks, I guess. I don't know. It's a touchy issue. And the answer is different for different games, right? I mean, I think that The Legend of Zelda, specifically, people get very up in arms at the idea over Link speaking. And I get it. You know, like, that's a long-time franchise, like, whatever else. Like, if a new franchise came along and they did that exact thing, that would be weirder than another Legend of Zelda game coming out and Link not speaking, you know? Unk Fanatic, UNC Fanatic, I guess, or says modern Pokemon really needs voice acting. Their games just seem so cheap now. I guess, yeah, I don't know, but those games are for kids and kids should learn to read anyway, right? I don't know. I think if you've got a game with a dialogue wheel that has things on it that are written like it's your character speaking, they should say that shit out loud when you pick it. Worked for Mass Effect. Worked really well for Mass Effect. So just do that. But yeah, it's a touchy subject. I don't think there's any specific right answer. I don't think there's any blanket answer you can apply to every video game. Right? I think it's something that you have to look at and go, okay, for these sorts of games, it makes a ton of sense. This game maybe gets a pass because of legacy, but these games get a pass because no one's voiced, you know, like I think there's a wide array of things, you know, like Mario is a weird one, right? Because Mario does speak, but he only says, you know, it's a me and let's a go. and wah ha 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 ha, you know, the important shit. I wonder if the portrayal of Mario in the film will lead to any sort of rethink on the Mario character and what he should be and what he should say and whatever else. Like, I wonder if they will, rethink speech in the Mario games based on, you know, whether they like the movie or not. I wonder what I'm sure Nintendo likes the money. I'm sure they can't argue with that. They're looking at it and going like, this is fucking awesome. Like, fuck the review. Like, oh, the reviews are mixed. Like, yeah, this money is the ultimate review. And it says, we're doing just fine. We'll see what word of mouth does. Maybe it dies week two and that becomes a bit of a rebuke or a bit of a, oh, well, I guess we marketed it well. But yes, specifically, do we get Super Mario Brothers, the movie, the game? Do they bring Chris Pratt into a vocal booth and have him say, "Wah ha 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 ha"? It's a me. I am Mario. Do they get these hot lines? Do they get?
Man, I can't believe it. I am Mario.
Do they go and get that for the games? One would presume there will be a sequel to the film. And in the movie, yeah, I don't know. Like, again, the you know, little clip of the film I saw, his portrayal of Mario sounded fine to me. I thought that Charlie Day's Luigi seemed pretty great. That seemed like a really good fit. Seeing it all on, like, seeing it all in that weird streaming window, that looked good to me. So, yeah, I don't know. I assume that cast returns in full for a sequel, right? They probably, I assume the contracts have options on them for, like, hey, unless something real bad happens, we are probably going to want to make a minimum of three of these. So I have to guess that they at least did that work to the clip I saw illegally. Hey, I was doing research. B, I clicked on a thing and then suddenly the movie was playing. That's not on me. I was looking for mostly nude women, and goddammit, they put the Mario movie in front of me with links to some gambling website thrown over the top of it. A really tremendous experience. So I will say, seeing that little bit of it, maybe that was what got me thinking, like, I should go see this movie in theaters. Maybe I should, you know, instead of waiting for it to come home, maybe I should take my daughter to go see this. Like, that was the kind of the thing that pushed me over the edge on that thinking. I still don't know that I'm going to, but, just because I don't know that she would have the patience to sit. Also, what if she was scared in a dark theater? I don't know. Yeah, that's I'm kind of thinking it through. Again, she's not quite four. Then you get up and leave in the middle. And so I'm thinking, like, I think that's probably how it would go. So maybe I just wait and then we can watch it at home. And then she can watch it the way she likes to watch movies, which is 50 times in a row. Which is Frozen 2 ended. And she says, can you put on other Frozen? Which is our code phrase for Frozen 2. There's Frozen and there's other Frozen. And then there's Fever Frozen, which is actually called Frozen Fever. But it's an animated short. Um, But she's also very into Mary Poppins. She recently had me start skipping the part in Mary Poppins where the bankers take the money from the boy because that scares her. She doesn't like it when they take his money. She doesn't like it when they take his money away from him. So we skip that scene now. And I was like, kid, when you get out into the real world, you're not going to. Let's see. I got this email. This is not an email to the podcast per se. So I get, by virtue of running a YouTube channel that has an email address on it, I get a lot of offers to stream video games for money. Mobile games, usually. You've seen the type around. You've seen these games around the block. You know the sorts of games I am speaking of. I received an offer that I am... I barely even ever read these, but for whatever reason, I read this one. Also, they did not BCC anyone on this email. They have sent... Oh, no, this is just other people at their company that they CC'd on it. Last week, I'm not even going to say the name of the game because they don't deserve the free press. Last week, the game was announced on the Unreal Engine stage at GDC, and then the open beta was released, which is live now. Please see more information regarding the opportunity below. Now, normally these opportunities are things like, okay, we'll create you, you need to tweet about this or do some kind of social media post about this. You need to stream for X number of hours with our bot in your channel so that we can direct people to download the game. And if they download the game and they play a certain amount of time, you get extra money or, you know, some kind of finder's fee for it. Or that's usually how most of these things are written. And you look at it and go like, well, okay, that makes sense. I see why people would do that. Like, I'm not throwing shade at people who do these offers. Like, I think it's, you know, if you're earning a living doing that, more power to you. I hope you are disclosing the stuff properly. This one stuck out at me. I'll read this offer to you. This is for a game that, again, is in some kind of open beta. We would love to put you forward to be part of the Early Bird game name creator program. The program provides exclusive access to the game. You'll be the first to know the latest and greatest about the title and upcoming news surrounding it. You'll be gifted in-game items. You'll be included in exclusive Discord and community groups to share the experience of game with other creators. You'll be given benefits, such as possible exposure on social media channels, and receive possible financial remuneration from the game wanting to license your content for paid ads, if you're interested in that opportunity. In return, all we ask for is a number of posts a month, which in the initial stages will be just one post a month, but we're open to more if you'd like. This is an unpaid opportunity, but as mentioned, you'll be provided with incentives. It also may generate paid opportunities in the future. So they're going to gift me in-game items in a mobile game in exchange for me posting about the game a minimum of once per month. That's grim. Most of these come with dollar figures attached. Like, hey, there's a minimum of this, but a maximum of this. You may, you know, if enough of your community and the high targets are always like basically impossible to hit, but like you as a maximum, you could get to this, you know, you could get to this amount of money. And then the hoops that they make everyone jump through to get to there is not, you know, feasible, and a lot of players won't hit it in the 3-day window or whatever window it is. And you know, they don't make the money. But at least in those situations, it's a dollar amount and not, we will invite you to our Discord and you will get exclusive items. Or, I'm sorry, not exclusive items, just in-game items. I'm fucking blown away at the audacity of this. This is an exclusive invite-only opportunity. However, if you have friends that like similar games, let us know. We can maybe invite them too. That's fucking wild, man. Like, anyone that I don't take offers like that. Get paid money for your work. This is the exact opposite of it. Maybe we can take one or two more emails here. Let's see. Dean from Kentucky writes in and says, I've been playing a lot of Crackdown 3 over the weekend. This game is bad. I'm sorry, Dean. You're right. It is. I'm still playing it, though. Crackdown 3's biggest advantage is that it shares some DNA with the original that I still hold in high regard, but it's felt like with each sequel, this series has strayed further from what made Crackdown so much fun. Here's my crack at the commandments of Crackdown, what should be the foundation of any game that carries the name. 1. It feels good to jump. 2. Environments are built to be jumped all over. 3. There will be orbs. 4. Everything you do earns XP towards at least one of the attributes, and by the time you've fully leveled, you should basically be a superhero. 5. Weapons and cars transform depending on your level. And 6. There is no story. Crackdown is up there with Viva Pinata as a franchise that I have no faith gets a sequel, but I still think it's possible to make a good Crackdown game in this day and age. I'd love to see a smaller team take a stab as a physics-y style game with more unique exploration that doesn't get bogged down with elements outside the commandments. Please consider helping spread my message, and feel free to add on anything you deem is essential before forwarding this to Phil. Yeah, I'll get right on that. Crackdown 3 is a bad game. A lot of that comes, I think the multiplayer end of it is particularly egregious, where it's just like this, especially for how it got like, oh, this is our cloud based, this and that. Like, the multiplayer aspect of that game is really abysmal. And Crackdown 3, which came out on Xbox One, its greatest sin, I think, is that it's really effing boring. And the environments and the structure of the city and the style of it is just bad. It's a bad follow-up to Crackdown. They did not capitalize on these commandments, which are solid. It's, yeah, if you're making a Crackdown game, it should do at a minimum those things. I might be able to go for a little bit more story, considering, you know, the ending of the first game was like a fun twist. But I thought Crackdown 2 sucked. I don't know. Like, Crackdown 2 gets a bit more of a pass because it was only the second one of those. But I think that the structure of the world, the layout, the structure of the gameplay and the flow through it as you make your way from start to finish is bad in Crackdown 2. And Crackdown 3 is worse in every regard. And just, man, what a bummer of a game. Crackdown 1 was awesome in its day, and it's not super easy to go back to. I don't know. It doesn't, like, it kind of doesn't hold up quite as well, as you want, I guess, but it's just quality of life stuff. Mostly you just go like, this type of open world game. I want more of this and more of that. but conceptually it's cool. And I think if you made I think you could do this game. I think you could still do this game. I think that was part of the magic of Saints Row 4, you know, is that it turned you into that superhero the way a Crackdown game did. And it still had a story and it still had all this silly shit going for it as well. And, you know, Crackdown. You're right. It almost would make sense for it to be a game from a smaller team these days. Like that almost, because of the lack of story, like, you know, you can get away with like not having a ton of high polished cutscenes and all the other shit, because that's not why you're there. You know, like a gameplay first open world game, crazy physics, weird upgrade system, crazy high jumps. Like, yeah, sure. Yeah. You could absolutely make one of those. And I think still have it work to a certain extent. I occasionally think about reinstalling Crackdown 3 and I cannot tell you why. There's a part of me of this is like, because I remember I played a lot of it. I did finish it when I reviewed it and everything else. And it was the first game I remember reviewing and thinking, this review is pointless. Like, as I was writing it, I was like, or not pointless, but like, this review does not serve the same purpose or it's not as useful in the same ways as other reviews have been because of Game Pass. And so, like, you know, there's two ways to review Crackdown 3, right? If you review it as a game you would purchase at full price, fucking don't. The only word is no. Do not buy Crackdown 3. Do not go spend money to pay for a full price copy of Crackdown 3. You do not need to do that. But from the point of view of, you already probably should subscribe to Game Pass, because Game Pass is, even today, I think that still holds true. Hey, you should probably have Game Pass. You then get into the thing of like, okay, well, for the price of this subscription I'm already paying for, should I play Crackdown 3? Crackdown 3, specifically. Like, the answer is probably still no. But also, fucking why not? Fuck it, download it. Unless you're on a data cap or, you know, you got some kind of reason why downloading it would be a pain in the ass. It's a time investment. And so that's a very different question. And that's a very personal question as well. Obviously, reviews and you know, because the money end of it was always a personal thing too, but at least that was a baseline that was fairly standard across all video games. You're like, hey, in a world where every video game costs $60, you can at least extrapolate from that, like, how does it stack up to these other $60 chunks of entertainment? And you can go, it's fucking bad. Turns out it's a bad investment of $60. Like, that stuff was easy. But, you know, the is a game worth this amount of money still became a very personal thing, because if you're some game loving billionaire, then you're like, it's for $60. What, you know, but if you're a kid who had to save up all summer to get enough money to buy one video game, you had better buy the right video game. And so, you know, even the money end of it is not as cut and dry as it maybe is. So, or maybe sounds. But once the argument became really about time, and is this worth your time, I don't know. Like, I like playing a wide variety of video games. And so for me, the answer to that question is almost always, yeah, you should install it and take a look at it. Especially for a game on Game Pass that you're not investing any additional money in, I'd be like, yeah, I don't know, man. Play an hour of Crackdown. If it grabs you, play more. If not, don't worry. You can walk away from it at any time. No harm done. Very little harm done. Zorgia in the chat says, I'd rather play Crackdown 3 than Red Dead Redemption 2. This is not a statement as to the quality of those two games in a comparative sense. It is more a statement about the types of games I like to play. But yeah, I guess I can agree with that, because I don't really like Red Dead. Crackdown 3 is a bad game. I would not call Red Dead a bad game. I would call Red Dead a game I don't like, and I don't find its world especially interesting I am not engaged by that story or those characters. Like, there are numerous things about Red Dead that kind of just push me away from it. And that's that. That you're going to find that with any game, any person, you know, it's like, whatever. Just not every game's for everybody anymore. That's just the way of things. But Crackdown 3, I would say, is a bad game in a lane that I play a lot of games in. If that makes any sense. So I don't know. Crackdown 3 is a bad game. Should they make a Crackdown 4? No. Should they reboot Crackdown? Maybe. I think what would you do with another Crackdown? God. Like, I guess, you know, if you stick to these commandments of, yeah, you jump high, you upgrade, you jump higher, you can do stuff, the vehicles transform, and that's funny. What do you do in that game? Is that enough? And I might say right now, there's more value in a Crackdown sequel now than there was when Crackdown 3 came out. Even when you take into account the damage that Crackdown 3 did to the good name of the franchise, which Crackdown 2 did damage to it anyway, so whatever. It just feels like there are fewer big, dumb open world games now. And the open world games that are coming out, they're trying to do more, they're trying to be more. Crackdown, a new Crackdown could just be that unabashed, fuck it, man, here you go. Jump around and shoot shit and take over territory, and it's just this fun, empty, like, what, you know, it's just this junk food thing, and get out there and blow shit up and have a good time and, you know, find some new technology hook to hang on it around destructibility or something, and make it, I don't know, maybe you could do a multiplayer thing, but then you get back into the, like, well, we look, our cloud servers and physics and syncing it up and all that other horseshit. Yeah, maybe if they put Chuck Norris and Michael Madsen in it, you know, make a new Crackdown. That'd be good. That'd be the solution, clearly. But yeah, I think a dumb, simple open world game that isn't trying to be anything more than that, I think that you could definitely do that. I think that could find an audience right now. Again, in a way that I think when Crackdown 3 came out, I think that there was the open world fatigue was pretty all-encompassing, whereas I think now a game like that would almost be viewed as a fun little throwback. Like, I remember when games weren't so serious and I wasn't stabbing the Pope or doing whatever in all these open world games. Pope Stabber, Black Flag, Pope Stabber, Odyssey, all these goddamn games. Like, remember when we just jumped around and shot the cops? What if we had one of those again? Like, yeah, I think you could sell that game. you could sell that game to people. I think you could sell that game as a weird throwback, honestly. As like, I don't know, you just shoot shit, and then when you shoot a bunch of stuff, a meter appears on screen and the cops come. And you can get away from them, or you can kill more of them, and then more of them will come. I don't know. I think you could make your kind of brain dead, simple throwback open world game with no story or very little story, and just do it. And it would probably work. How well, you know, like, does it work as a big AAA $1 billion launch? Like, no, but, you know, could you make that game make sense and probably make money in the marketplace? Yeah, probably. Yeah. Probably. Let's see. Is there one more question to take here? Oh, this is a really long one. I got a really long email from Spilly about the modern music industry. Spilly is someone who had some popular TikToks and went on to have some music. I'm not going to read this right now, but thank you for that email a few weeks ago. Maybe we'll get to it on the show, but it is a bit long, and about, like, just the nature of what the music industry is nowadays and how desperate they all seem over there in the companies of music distribution and how weird they all are. But yeah, that's going to about do it. Thanks everybody for listening. It's been a heck of a show. There's a lot of news this week. Not a ton of like big new games, but a ton of little stuff. I've also been checking in with Meet Your Maker, and I updated my base. I updated the Murder Costco in a way that I think will make it murder more, because people weren't dying in the back half of it enough. And so I redid the entire back half of it to make it more murdery. And I have high hopes for it. I hope we're going to stack up some more dead bodies on that one. I'll have to check in. I did that last night. And so that base is still up and running right now. If you want to go find it for yourself, I guess. Yeah, let me hit the music. Let's see. What else is going on? Yeah, you can sign up for the Patreon over at patreon.com/Jeff Gerstmann. That'll get you the hookup for an ad-free version of this podcast. You can also get access to early episodes of the Jeff Gerstmann Hall of Fame. You can also get access to Game Boys to Men, the hottest podcast about 1994 you've ever heard. The most recent episode just went up last night, and we're talking about the magazine we worked for in 1994. And I think the realization of just like, yeah, we were not really equipped as people to have that job. But also, it was a frustrating time for a variety of reasons. And it was interesting. Yeah, and there's some pictures of the magazine in there in that video that you should see. I'll post those, the rest of those, to the Discord. I will post them to Patreon so people can find them that way. Yeah, I'll be back Wednesday, Friday. That's the plan. A dental appointment notwithstanding, but, you know, should be normal times, normal streams this week. I'll see you then.